on DAB Plus, online, via the Talksport app, and on your smart speaker.
Absolutely incredible!
The Euro 2024 qualifiers, live on Talksport 2.
It's the start of a huge few days for Scotland. Steve Clarke's men are top of their group, and the pathway to the Euros looks to be opening up.
Unbelievably, it's Scotland 1, Spain 0, and suddenly Scotland's dream of beating the top side in Group A is on.
In these competitions, and with the squad that we have, you know, results will come, and the results have been coming.
And it's Scotland 2, Spain 0, and there is the Hampden roar that greets an historic win, a win of a generation.
Straight away, you know, the difficult times, the climate, the way that it is, this is exactly what the nation needs. You know, you talk about communities, societies, this is exactly what it needs.
For them, it's also an important game, so I think two good teams and hopefully a good match.
In towards Holland, we have our first goal, and who else would score it but Erling Haaland?
Well, clearly it's one of the finest goal scorers that the game has ever had.
And Erdegaard, who is always going to be the danger man, has wrapped a brilliant shot from the edge of the area.
It nearly frightened me for a small country like Norway.
No, he's not the Vieira, he's not a Roy Keane, but he's Martin Ødegaard.
In these competitions, and with the squad that we have, you know, results will come, and the results have been coming.
There's still a long way to go in the group, and as we know to our cost, one game can cost you dearly.
Saturday night drama brought to you by Talksport 2. Yeah, lots to look forward to for Scotland. Their first clash with Norway for a decade. But most importantly for Steve Clarke and co, Scotland looking to continue their perfect start to Euro 2024. They are top of the group with 6 points from two games. Two huge matches coming up in the next few days. Georgia will come to Hampden on Tuesday, but first a trip to Norway. If Scotland can come through the next few days unscathed, they'll have real hope of reaching Germany next year. Lots to look forward to. Team news in just a moment. First, though, myself, Joe Shannon, alongside the former Scotland international, Charlie Adam. Charlie, very good afternoon to you.
Good afternoon. You okay?
Yeah, very good, thanks. Really looking forward to this. And for Scotland and Steve Clarke, how do they approach this tonight, Charlie, given the position that they're in?
Well, they're in a good position. Obviously, they've can rely on the playoff already. So I think this is a game where Scotland have to go and attack. I think, why wouldn't you want to go and try and win the football match? The nation, this group of players are in good form, very confident after that Spain match, and it's just seeing what the lads have come from the end of a tough, busy season. You know, are they ready? Are they prepared? Which I expect them to be, with Steve and the staff there, ready to go and give themselves a big opportunity to stamp their authority on this group.
Is this the best Scotland side you've seen for some time?
Yeah, I think so. I think this is a group with a lot of different strengths, and the results have shown that. The performances, qualifying for a major tournament for a long time, he's just got everything right at the moment. And we were talking off air on how he's progressed off the pitch, the way that they prepare is different from when I was involved. And so yeah, it's all going good, but like Steve said, one bad result in this group can cost you.
Scotland are in Oslo this afternoon at the Ullevaal Stadium, which is slowly filling up. The Tartan Army are here as well. About 1,300 Scotland fans have made the trip, and kickoff on TalkSport 2 is just over 10 minutes away. Just a reminder of where Scotland sit ahead of the start of the afternoon. Scotland top of Group A, 6 points in two games, three clear of Spain, and five clear of Norway, who haven't won a game yet, just a point from their two played so far. Let's bring you the team news now. One change for Scotland, for the side that most memorably beat Spain at Hampden on the 28th of March. Jack Hendry back in the team for the injured Grant Hanley. Gunn in goal, Porteous, Hendry and Tierney the defenders, Hickey and Robertson the wingbacks, McTominay and McGregor in midfield, Christie and McGinn in support of Lyndon Dykes up front. And for Norway, the headline team news is that Erling Haaland does start. We expected that, even despite his exploits with Manchester City, of course, that famous treble win and all of the celebrations that have followed. But Norway were saying before the game they expected Haaland to play, and so he does play, as does Ødegaard, who captains the side. It's Nyland in goal. Ryerson is coming at right back for the injured Pedersen in the other Norway change. Strandberg, Ostergaard and Melling the defenders. Ødegaard, Berg and Arsnes in midfield. Sørloth, Solbakken and Haaland are the front three. And of course, Charlie Adam, all of the talk before the game about how Scotland will try to deal with Erling Haaland. We will hear from Steve Clarke on that in just a moment. But for any manager in the world, for any team in the world, it's a very difficult ask, isn't it, at times?
Yeah, absolutely. I think he's the best number nine in the world in current football. His numbers last year were incredible, and his numbers for Norway are amazing as well. So when you've got that attention, he plays at, like say, European champions again, and it'll only bring more spotlight on him. But he can handle that. He's, you know, he's a top player, and he's been doing it for a number of seasons now. But Scotland will know that if they give him half a chance. You see the goals that he scored over the last few years, all different types of goals, and yeah, he's a handful. But I don't think you can always just think about one player or Odegaard. Like Alexander Solot, I think, is a very good player. He's got 5 and 6, so there's a lot of good players. You look at their squad, they're playing in different leagues, but they're playing in the top clubs in that country. So yeah, it's a difficult match, but the Scotland should be confident.
Well, the Scotland boss, I think, feels similarly. We all know about Haaland's stats. He's a treble winner. He's got 21 goals for Norway in just 23 games. He's already their 8th highest scorer of all time at the age of 22. 52 goals for Manchester City last season, record 36 in the Premier League. Steve Clarke, though, says, as Charlie has said, really, it'd be a mistake for Scotland to obsess over stopping Haaland.
As we always do, we concentrate on ourselves, we prepare properly for the game, we respect our opponents. We play Norway, the team, and hopefully Scotland, the team, are a little bit better on the night.
In terms of the way your team has started then, and the confidence they have, do you feel that Scotland now come into these games expecting to win rather than anything else?
No, I think we should come with confidence. Obviously we had a good march, we've had a good run of wins in competitive fixtures, but we know we're coming to a difficult place, so like I say, we always respect our opponents. We try and play as well as we can, and hopefully we can add to the points tally that we've already got.
That's the Scotland boss, Steve Clarke. Charlie, I think typically measured from the Scotland head coach, you wouldn't really expect anything less from him.
No, he's someone I've managed to obviously worked with at Liverpool, and very calm, composed, you know, says the right things all the time, and has done a wonderful job. I think even at club level, we talked about before, the jobs that he's done for a club level has been brilliant, and he's just brought it onto the national team, and he's setting a standard for the players. But you know, these group of players have done a fabulous job so far, and I just think that Steve, the longer he's in the job, the more improvement we'll have.
The back three has been really effective in these opening two games against Spain and Cyprus. You look at the front three today, ostensibly a front three, but do we expect Ryan Christian, John McGinn to certainly drop in a little deeper, particularly when Scotland don't have the ball?
I think it will be like a sort of 3-4 box, one up front. Dykes will play up his own. I think McGinn and Christie might just play at the back of Dykes to try and stop Patrick Berg getting on the ball and trying to dictate the play, and getting Odegaard and Ornis on the ball in the higher position. So if they can get around him and then break from there, because you've got great pace and energy from Robertson and Hickey on the wide in the fullback area. So it's something they have to stop. Try and control that midfield, because the quality of Norway's in there as well. And you know, it's midfield in any game is always crucial.
For Norway, in the build-up to the game, the manager Ståle Solbakken has pretty much described this as a must-win, and he's been very open with that. Does that put extra pressure on some of these Norway players, maybe?
A little, but also I think it's good that they've. It gives them the responsibility to say, listen, we must win the game. You know, we can't draw, we can't afford the defeat, we need to win the game. So for Scotland, that might mean that Norway come and open up a little bit more, and they can counter-attack. So yeah, I just think the manager's, he believes in his group of players, and he knows that they're ready, and putting that onus on them.
We'll bring you the latest odds very, very shortly. Teams with the tunnel though, and emerging out onto the field of play in Oslo on a bright and sunny day, about 28 degrees here at the National Stadium, the home ground of the national team. It's full to its 28,000 capacity, in Scotland in their all-white change kit with blue trim out onto the field, and Norway, the red shirts, the dark blue shorts and socks, and both sets of players now going to line up astride the halfway line. It's a spectacular setting, this, an intimate and compact setting as well. And of course, before the game gets underway, we'll have the usual pre-match rituals, including the national anthem, starting with Scotland. Tartan Army Roar, you'd be forgiven for thinking that Scotland were the home side. We'll get a word from Charlie Adam in a moment, but first, the national anthem of Norway. Rendition of the Norwegian national anthem. Let's get the latest odds with 888 Sport.
Football form focus on Talksport 2 with 888 Sport. Made to challenge, made to debate, made to play. 18 plus begambleaware.org.
A Norway win today is at 10 to 11. A Scottish win you can get at 3 to 1. The draw 5 to 2. Those are the latest odds thanks to 888 Sport. 18 plus. Gamble responsibly. Begambleaware.org.
Football form focus on Talksport 2 with 888 Sport. Made to challenge, made to debate, made to play. 18 plus begambleaware.org.
You're with Talksport 2 ahead of a huge Euro 2024 qualifier. Norway against Scotland. The Scots in pole position at the top of Group A. Another victory would take them further clear of the chasing pack. All important, potentially, in the race for a place at Euro 2024. The sun is shining in Oslo. I'm Joe Shannon, the former Scotland midfielder. Charlie Adam alongside me. Charlie, we heard that rousing rendition from the Tartan Army of the Scottish National Anthem. They will be the 12th man again today, but on the field, you just get the sense of the Scotland team with much more confidence than we've seen in recent years.
Yeah, listen, Scotland fans will follow, you know, near and far to support the country, but when things are going well, you know, the feel-good factor is that they're going with an expectation now to go to Norway to get a result. It's a tough game, but you know, these fans are brilliant, and the players will feed off that, and if they can get a result today, then it gives them a great opportunity going forward in the group.
And when you talk about getting a result, would Steve Clarke take a draw today ahead of the Georgia match at Hampden?
I think if you take 4 points from these two games, I think he'd be very happy. You know, obviously Spain are not playing this week in terms of the group, so it's important that Scotland gets something from this match. It keeps Norway further away from them, and then if you can get 3 points, would be magnificent. But a draw, for me, I think would be a good result.
TalkSport and TalkSport 2, your home of the Euro qualifiers, England against North Macedonia, live on TalkSport on Monday night from Wembley. And Turkey against Wales will be on TalkSport 2 as Wales look to bounce back from that shock defeat to Armenia. Once the international summer is done, we will be your home of the Premier League once again. More than 110 exclusive Premier League commentaries this season coming on the network. More live football on the radio than anywhere else. Will be your home of the EFL, the FA Cup, the Carabao Cup, the Champions League, the Women's Super League and the Euros next summer. All live on the network. And of course for Scotland, the road to Germany and the road to Euro 2024, they hope, continues right here. It's the first of two massive games. Tuesday, they're at home to Georgia, but right now, away to Norway and Erling Haaland. We are live on TalkSport 2, and it'll be Norway to get the game underway. Playing from right to left here at the Ullevål Stadion. Norway, the red shirts, blue shorts and blue socks, and Scotland all in white with blue trim, playing from left to right towards the end of the field that houses the Scotland supporters, and Andy Robertson has let the ball trickle out of play for an early Scotland throw. Scotland with gunning goal, Porteous, the returning Hendry, and Tierney the defenders, with Hickey and Robertson the wingbacks, McGregor and McTominay in midfield, McGinn and Christie in support of Lyndon Dykes up front. I'll give you the Norway side in just a moment, but the ball is deep into Scotland territory and a commanding header clear by Jack Hendry up to the halfway line. Norway win it back just inside their own half of the field. They have Oyan Neeland, the goalkeeper who's played for several clubs in England in goal. Ryerson, Strandberg, Ostergaard, formerly of Brighton, and Melling at the back. Ødegaard, the captain, the Arsenal skipper too, with Berg and Arsenis alongside him in midfield. Alexander Sørloth, who used to play for Crystal Palace, and Ole Solbakken either side of Erling Haaland up front. And it doesn't take a rocket scientist to work out, Charlie Adam, that Scotland's hopes in some ways today hinge on keeping Haaland as quiet as they possibly can. But they have an early attack to defend here, and out comes the goalkeeper Gunn to claim on the edge of his penalty area.
Yeah, it's massive that they do keep him quiet if they can, because it gives them an opportunity to then progress in the game. But just watching Scotland, they're 5-4-1 at the moment, just waiting and allowing Norway to have a little bit of possession. Berg's trying to get on the ball, but you know, Dykes is just dropping back onto that sixth position. So a little bit of cat and mouse so far. Scotland, they just have to get a little bit of hold of the game, get the ball down and start passing it around and build confidence into the match.
Scotland, who are yet to concede a goal in qualifying, that hugely impressive victory at Hampden over Spain, which was preceded by a comfortable win over Cyprus. Scott McTominay has scored 4 of the 5 goals in qualifying, has got the ball down by the dead ball line. He skipped towards the edge of the penalty area, but he'd actually taken it out of play, and it's gone behind for a goal kick to Norway away to our right. It's Norway nil, Scotland nil.
Perfect start. That's what you want from McTominay. That's what he's in there for. He's got good energy, good legs. Ball rolled into Berg, and he goes and nicks it off him. A little bit of a touch, it ends up going out for a goal kick, but that's the intent of what Scotland are doing. They don't want to sit back. They want to go and press in midfield and not allow Norway too much time on the ball.
Steve Clark standing on the edge of his technical area, the Scotland head coach, in pretty sweltering conditions today. He's been very vocal but calm and measured as ever about how Scotland deserved to come into today's game with confidence. And it's a Scotland side that feels like it's still flying high after that excellent start to the campaign back in March. Here is an opportunity for Norway to build with Ødegaard, the number 10. 10 yards shy of the halfway line as the sun gets ever brighter here beneath blue skies. And now Patrick Berg, the defensive midfielder, takes up possession 10 yards shy of halfway. Strandberg out towards the right back position in Ryerson, but it's seized upon by Scotland, and an opportunity for Andy Robertson to burst forward. Strandberg will send it all the way back to his goalkeeper, who's under immediate pressure from the Scotland skipper. Leland very calm on the ball though, and Berger Melling can streak forward up over the halfway line for Norway. Has to check his run under pressure from Lyndon Dykes, and Scotland look very well organised in the first 3.5 minutes, 0-0.
Yeah, just there, Robertson next to the ball. McGinn could have done a little bit better with the pass, but good composure from Ireland, the goalkeeper. You know, allowed it across his body, rolls out to Melling, and they start to attack. But like we expected, Norway to have a bit of possession. Dykes just dropping in. Scotland not allowing the ball through the midfield, not wanting to break, to get it into Ødegaard or midfielders in between the lines for Norway, because if you do and they get on the half turn, it causes you problems. So we're trying to force them to the fullback so that our wing backs can get higher and push on and try and nick the ball higher up the pitch.
Scotland playing with confidence for good reason, unbeaten in their last 6 competitive matches as they bid to qualify for the Euros for the second such tournament in succession. And Norway, for all of the talents in their side and all of the talent that Norway have had sporadically, at least over the years, haven't qualified for any sort of major tournament since the year 2000 and the European Championships at the start of this century.
Yeah, Strandberg there just rolling out to Ryerson, that goes over his boot. But I think it's difficult to qualify for tournaments. You know, if your coefficient is not right, then it makes it a lot harder. And the longer you go without qualifying for tournaments, you've seen with Scotland 20 odd years before they qualified, and you just need that right group of players that can get you over the line. And Norway might just be going in that little bit of a transition, but they're getting the quality players through the building and into the squad and into the team now that possibly they can eventually qualify for a tournament.
They arguably have the hottest property in world football on the ball at the moment in Haaland on the halfway line. And now an opportunity for Melling, who is 10 yards into Scotland territory near side the left. He plays it back to the halfway line now. And an opportunity for Strandberg, the number 4, gets the square ball to his feet by the former Brighton man, Leo Ostergaard. One or two Norway fans arriving late to fill those remaining empty seats in this impressive stadium. And now Ostergaard again. He's played it back to the goalkeeper. Looked a little bit short, that pass initially, under pressure from Ryan Christie, but it's a good clearance by Nealon down the Norway right, and Ryerson will get to it in front of Andy Robertson, but his touch under pressure is a little heavy, and it's gone out of play for a goal kick to Scotland.
Yeah, just a long ball over the top of Robertson, but he defended it well. Ryerson got on the end, but he put it out for a goal kick. But you know, Norway with Haaland up there, they're not afraid to go long and try and, you know, turn Scotland at the moment. But yeah, decent enough start from Scotland. Just if we can get somebody, can get on the player. That's why, you know, McGregor is key. If he can get McGregor on the ball and he can start dictating the game for Scotland and get passes, get possession, then, you know, we can build confidence into this group.
Just a third senior cap for Angus Gunn, the goalkeeper, who's played in every single one of the three qualifying campaign matches so far. It's his clearance over the halfway line, and then a poor ball straight out of play by Fredrik Arsnes for Norway. And it's a Scotland throw in their right full-back position on the near side as we look at it. 0-0 live on TalkSport 2, if you're just joining us. And it's so significant, isn't it, today, Charlie? Because Scotland top of the group and 5 points clear of Norway. If they were to win their next two, Scotland, so including today, and at home to Georgia, they'd be on 12 points at the halfway stage. Norway at that point could only reach a maximum of 16. So it really is important for Scotland that, and certainly they don't lose, but a win would put them in a really good position.
Absolutely, you know, this is a key match. When you're playing against, you know, the results that they've had previously, to come to Norway and get a big result, a win, would definitely go, you know, a long way to keeping them at arm's length and trying to qualify for Germany, which would be great. But, you know, if we switch off at any moment, you know, when they've got Odegaard, they've got Haaland, it could cause you a lot of problems. So we have to keep concentrating for 90 minutes, because we'll get an opportunity tonight, and if we can do that, hopefully the ball finds the right players and we can get a win.
It's a good atmosphere around the stadium. The Scotland fans with that rip-roaring rendition of the national anthem before the game. About 1,300 have made the trip. I'm sure that had there been a bigger allocation, Scotland would have sold that out as well. The support is so often so key, home and away, to this Scotland team. And actually, during the national anthem, there were a couple of Darvel FC fans who were asking for Erling Haaland to make the move north of the border.
Yeah, just I think it's just what supporters that we realise how good a talent he is. And, you know, he's obviously enjoyed the last 2 weeks of the season, hasn't he?
Yeah.
Winning three trophies. It's an incredible achievement as a footballer moving from Dortmund. But, you know, you've got to enjoy these moments as a footballer.
Doesn't feel like it's something that Scotland are too fussed about, and certainly not Steve Clarke, who spoke about the bigger picture coming into the game. Odegaard has scooped the ball high downfield. It's going to be an easy header away at the heart of the Scotland back line for Jack Hendry, but the loose ball drops to Odegaard, the number 10 again. He's got Ryerson in support on the right, level with the edge of the Scotland penalty area. Still goalless on TalkSport 2. Ryerson with the red boots on, crosses, and it's high into that crowded penalty box. Nobody in a red shirt can get their head on it, though. Mellinger's won it back down by the near side for Norway. He's deflected the ball off Christie, and I think the referee and his assistant have said throw to Norway right by the corner flag. The home fans, you can hear, they feel it was a corner, and they're not happy. There are two balls on the pitch now, and the referee's just going to have to come across. Mate Jug is the referee, and stop the game, get rid of the second ball. And actually, it looks like it'll be a drop ball, which of course is uncontested these days, at the feet of Melling. And Norway will have the ball back again deep inside Scotland territory. Melling down by the dead ball line, plays it backwards to Arsnes, the shaven-headed midfielder. A deep cross into the penalty area, but it's way overhit and out of play for a goal kick. And Scotland have looked relatively comfortable in the first 10 minutes.
Yeah, we're just waiting for that, you know, that cross to come in the box there. But, you know, Haaland just waiting for the second ball, too high, too long, but he's a threat. You know, as soon as you get that ball out of your feet and put it into an area, then the goals that he scored, his movement is very dangerous. But, you know, Scotland looking to build up from the back from goal kicks and things like that. So they're pretty confident at the moment, and hopefully we can get more of the ball and use it better than we did there.
It's a huge game at Hampden on Tuesday against Georgia, another game that Scotland will certainly be a game that they will expect to win. First, though, they have to keep their focus on matters in Oslo, and it's been a quiet start in terms of goal mouth action. 0-0 it remains, and that will suit Steve Clarke's team. The Norway boss, Ståle Solbakken, might be a familiar name to some of you, especially if you're a Wolves fan. There was a a sort of half season at Wolves that didn't go very well in the end in 2012-2013 for starter Saul Backman, but he's certainly rebuilt his reputation since then. A very successful coach at Copenhagen in Denmark over a couple of spells there, multiple league titles, as Norway, who had most of the possession so far, win it back off Scott McTominay, and a square ball out to the right back position for Mostigard to find Ryerson. But I don't think Steve Clark will be unduly worried, Charlie, because we all expected Norway to have more of the ball.
Yeah, but I think it's the passes there from Portis, straight passes into McTominay when he's got somebody there up against him, and when he could just open up and go out the other side quickly into the goalkeeper, out to Tierney. So it's important that we keep moving the ball and we just don't entice Norway onto his, if it's straight passes into to midfield where they can come and nick it, because Haaland won't come and press you quickly. You know, he will run around, but he won't come and press, you know, with real intensity. So you can allow yourself to build up and attack the game a little bit better. So if Scotland can do that, they always got your goalkeeper to come out the other way and get it the other side.
Angus Gunn's had to race out to the edge of his penalty area to hack the ball into touch. It's a Norway throw, over the edge of the 18-yard box. There are Norwegian flags flying in the lower tier behind the goal to the left. And that last third of the pitch is in shade. The rest of the field of play has, for the most part, been bathed in that brilliant Norway sunshine. Here is Ostergaard, just shy of halfway, plays for Napoli these days. And now Melling pushing the ball forward to Haaland, caught in the penalty area. Of course, this is where he's so dangerous. Haaland, with his back to goal though, turned away from Hendry, who was watching him intently. Norway have it with Berg midway inside the Scotland half, and Scotland with basically everybody in white back behind the ball. And Norway, though they've had a lot of the possession, finding it relatively difficult to pass and probe through those backs of Scotland defence.
Yeah, good distances from midfield to defenders to Lyndon Dykes there, not allowing, you know, Odegaard or Aarons in behind them to cause them problems. So it's important that Norway allow.
The Solbakken clips it across, left footed, and a free header straight at the goalkeeper from Serlot. He should have done much better there, the former Crystal Palace striker. Norway really with their first sight of goal in the game, and Scotland, for all of their defensive organisation up to this point, maybe got a little bit of a let-off, still 0-0.
Yeah, good skill from Solbakken there. Just hangs it up in the area there for Solbakken. We knew he's dangerous, scored a few goals recently in the last few appearances, but straight Angus Gunn. I think if he looks back at that, if it's either side of Angus Gunn, it's probably a goal, but it was straight arm. So Scotland have to watch. Hickey has to get closer there, not allowing that cross.
It was planted straight into the gloves of the goalkeeper. And as you say, Charlie, Alexander Sorlot, who never really made the grade at Crystal Palace, albeit maybe made the move a little too young to the Premier League at that stage in his career, but he's got 16 goals for Norway in 47 appearances and scored the opener in what turned into a very frustrating draw in Georgia last time out in the group stages for Norway. And they're on the attack now with Solbakken looking to reach a raking ball, but it's out of play. The throw to Scotland in the right back position. Well, that was a warning sign.
So. Yeah, it was a warning sign. It was good. The free header as well. You know, looking back, he was frustrated there, seeing that he probably should have done better straight at the goalkeeper. But it's good play from Norway, getting it wide in 1v1 situation. Hickey's got to do better, but Solot definitely disappointed with that.
A long throw by Porteous upfield, little flick by Ryan Christie. Lyndon Dykes trying to hold up play for Scotland number 9, about 10 yards shy of halfway, and Scotland have won a free kick in their right back spot midway inside their own half the field after a foul by Ostergaard. The referee gestures to the Norway defender just to keep calm and keep cool. Quarter of an hour gone, Norway 0, Scotland 0 is the latest score. We've got more live football from the European qualifiers on Monday night. England against North Macedonia, live on TalkSport, and on TalkSport 2 there'll be commentary of Turkey against Wales, and Andy Robertson not happy with the referee at this point, but it's Norway who get the decision just into the Scotland half.
Yeah, it's, you know, Henry's trying to chip a ball and it's hit Odegaard in the head, and Robertson has gone out for a throw, but you know, they've gave it against Scotland, but no decision from the referee. But going back to that chance again, it's something that you've got to watch, you know, especially away from home. You keep your shot 10-15 minutes, don't give the opposition an opportunity, and they did there. But fortunately for Scotland, it was straight into Angus Gunn. But you know, Scotland looked like they're well organised, disciplined in terms of not really wanting to press the ball, waiting for that straight pass, and they can't allow Berg to get turned and start dictating the game, because it'll be a long afternoon if you do.
Odegaard driving forward inside right channel. He's played it further wide to Sorloth, who is a big striker. There is a real aerial threat among the front three for Norway, and it doesn't just come from Erling Haaland.
I'm looking here, and they look a big side, don't they?
Yeah.
You know, Melling, even the left back, is tall, over 6 foot, so set plays will be key as well for Scotland.
Melling into the D is giving it away. Scotland were patient defensively there, and John McGinn is the man who's nipped in to win it back. He spins away from three in red, and the Scotland midfielder doesn't get the free kick. Arms outstretched in front of the referee. Solbakken's early ball to the edge of the penalty area is headed away by Hendry, and Scotland just need to keep their composure in a slightly difficult spell for them now. 16 minutes into the game, and Norway really dominating possession and actually seeing more and more territory, more and more now. The game is being played in the Scotland halfway to our left.
Yeah, the distance are getting big between McTominay keeps trying to come and jump out his slot into Berg, and it's allowing big spaces between him and McGregor. So it's important that Scotland don't go chasing and feel frustrated, because at times when the opposition have a lot of the ball, you could jump from your position, and then all of a sudden you make big gaps, and it's not what Steve wants. You want to keep it compact and force it wide, and get the fullbacks to deal with their wingbacks.
Norway started with the defeat on the road to Spain, and a trip to Georgia that, as I say, ended in a very frustrating draw for them. They have back-to-back home games in the group stages in Group A to come, including a must-win match here, you feel, against Cyprus on Tuesday. And they have the ball with Strandberg just inside Scotland territory. Forward now to Ryerson with the dyed blonde hair, the Dortmund man. Back it goes to Strandberg again. Strandberg forward to Berg, who is midway inside the Scotland half. Right of centre as we look at it. It's played back into a central position in Odegaard. Odegaard, that familiar figure in midfield. And now it's taken up by Ola Solbakken. Corner of the penalty area. Forward to Ryerson inside left channel. He whips in a deep cross. Ryerson far post. It's cleared away. Comes out to Odegaard. Edge of the D. Odegaard onto that left foot. He's blocked off by McTominay. There was a moment of concern for the Scotland fans there. Scotland smuggle it clear over halfway. No foul by Ostergaard on Lyndon Dykes. But there's always a moment of real concern whenever Odegaard receives the ball in that kind of position.
Yeah, he's magic in that position, that 10 position. You could see a pass, but again, that run from midfield again is causing Scotland problems in the back of Porteous, in between Hickey and Porteous, not matching the run.
Odegaard 25 yards out, thinks about a shot. He's been forced towards the left hand side, sets up Solbakken on the corner of the penalty area. He dinks it up to the chest of Porteous. He was appealing that it was a handball by the Watford man, was Solbakken, and the referee signalling that he is speaking to VAR about it.
No, it's never a penalty. He clips, chips up against him, but a warning sign again there from Norway, given, you know, Scotland giving them plenty of time to get turned and in the box.
Well, he's a yard away there, Porteous, and I think Solbakken has actually just deliberately chipped it up onto his arm, yeah. It looked like. No penalty. And the VAR concern for Scotland is very quickly over, and rightly so. Norway 0, Scotland 0 in the 19th minute of the game on TalkSport 2. Scotland, who won their last meeting with Norway, it was here in 2013, and Charlie Adam was in the team that day.
I was there. That was terrible. But I remember playing there. Yeah, Scott Brown scored the winner, 1-0 we won.
Well, that's very honest of you, Charlie.
Nyland, actually, the goalkeeper tonight, was playing as well. So
yeah,
he's obviously got a few grey hairs now as well.
And destined for a career in broadcasting, yeah, one day, maybe.
But like, say, you know, looking at Odegaard now, he's just starting to pick up their little position, isn't he? In half turn, yeah, going and penetrating from that central position. So we have to try and stop the supply to Odegaard, because you see in the Premier League, week in, week out, the performance he's shown at Arsenal, that, you know, when he gets time and space, he can win a match for anybody.
I haven't seen much from Scotland on the ball so far, but they have possession now with Porteous. Forward to McGregor in the centre circle, onto McTominay. McTominay breaking between the lines. He's skipped away from Berg and laid it left to Andy Robertson. Robertson's got McGinn in support. Back he goes to McGinn. Midway inside Norway territory, hugging that far side touchline. Lovely reverse ball to find Robertson in the penalty area, trying to pull it back. Across came Berg. Excellent patience from McGinn. Lovely weight on the pass. And Robertson wins Scotland the corner in front of the travelling tartan army.
Yeah, good. Scotland getting 7 or 8 passes together there, you know, and opening up that position, playing on the opposite pocket there to to him again and getting there. And a bit of composure and Robertson bombing on like he does, gets us a corner. So
that's Manchester United, Scott McTominay, who will take it. Scotland fans right behind that goal on their feet, lots of replica shirts on show. McTominay's corner in towards Dykes at the near post. I think he got a glancing touch on it. The ball rolled across the edge of the 6-yard box. It's come back to the near side now, and Kieran Tierney with the golden boots on. Not a bad delivery, headed away by Haaland inside the penalty area. It's come back out now to Callum McGregor, and the Celtic man will calm the play down. Back it went to the centre circle, and Robertson now is diagonal ball is headed infield by Tierney, and across came Jack Hendry to win Scotland another corner.
Yeah, good play from Scotland, just keeping it alive, going back to Robertson, clipping in there, and, you know, putting a little bit of pressure on this Norway defence. But it was actually a decent ball from McTominay, you know, it gets across, Dykes gets across, nobody really coming around the back, somebody should have been there, but we kept it alive and we got another corner.
This is more like it from Scotland, and can they strike perhaps from a set play here? Plenty forward inside a crowded 18-yard box. It's McGinn to loft it high into the 6-yard area, but too close to the green-clad goalkeeper, Nieland. He's there to pluck it out of the sky.
Yeah, it was too high, McGinn. No real conviction on going and wrapping his foot around it. Too much air in it, and it was easy for the goalkeeper to collect in his 6-yard box.
0-0 it remains. John McGinn, who has barely missed a Premier League game in recent seasons for Aston Villa, scored against Cyprus in Group A in Scotland's first game of the qualification campaign. Scotland, who once they have met Georgia on Tuesday, go to Cyprus in September, Spain in October, and then a trip to Georgia before a home game against Norway in November to end the campaign. Who knows where Scotland will be at that stage?
He's in some goal-scoring form from again for Scotland, isn't he?
Yeah.
You know, 16 goals. But yeah, he's done brilliant for the national team.
Robertson tearing down the left. Opportunity for Christie, who couldn't quite get it under his full control. He tried to spin away instinctively from the defender. He did that, but his touch was heavy. And Nealon, the goalkeeper, able to claim.
Yeah, brilliant play from Andy Robertson. Cutting it back there. Christie just a little bit, you know, heavy touch and goes into goalkeeper. But good positive signs from Scotland in the last few minutes. A couple of corners, getting into that Norway half, getting into the box, putting them under pressure.
Scotland's best spell of the game so far, midway through the first half, and they look like they've got through that early flurry of Norway pressure. Norway with Melling, the blonde-haired left-back, on the halfway line. The sun is back out again at the Ullevål Stadion. Now Strandberg, midway inside his own half, out to the right-back position, and Ryerson back to Strandberg again. A Strandberg forward ball intercepted by Robertson, but then straight back into the path of Berg, and an opportunity for Sorlot to drive forward into the penalty area. Tierney is back with him. Tierney got the touch. Sorlot, the much bigger of the two players, manages to use his physicality and force Tierney into conceding the corner.
Yeah, good defender from Tierney. Just when he gets back, recovers, just a heavy touch, and I don't think it's a foul. He's, you know, he just took the heavy touch in corner. We've got to defend this better, but you know, it was good from Tierney, good position, recovered well from it.
Scotland have brought everybody back to counter this pretty potent Norway aerial threat. They're not in good form at the moment, Norway. Their last competitive win was just over a year ago against Sweden in the Nations League. No win in four competitive matches since then. And today is the first time they've had Haaland at all in the qualifying campaign. He missed the two matches in March. There's a head-to-head between Ostergaard and Porteous, and Ostergaard has shoved his opposite number to the ground.
Yeah, it could be a good battle, that. You've seen Ostergaard there with Christie in the touchline, leaving a little bit on him. I can imagine Porteous, you know, he would do the same. So it'll be a good battle in these set plays. Don't get too tight, grabbing each other and giving away a penalty. And
Porteous, who's really impressed in the Championship since moving to Watford.
Yeah, he's always been that one that you thought that had the potential.
Martin Ødegaard will take the corner. Norway's first corner of the game. It'll be a left-footed in-swing delivery from the far side, whipped into the 6-yard box, and that is easy for Angus Gunn. It was almost a carbon copy of McGinn's corner for Scotland
a few minutes ago. Well done. Good confidence for Angus Gunn. You know, third cap tonight, and I think it was a good move from Steve to come and take him to Scotland. We were losing a lot of caps in terms of Marshall and Gordon with injury at the moment, so It was good to get somebody like an Angus Gunn who's good potential and get him in and play regular for Scotland. But going back to Porteous, like you said about the Championship, done really well coming down from Hibs. You know, at times his discipline in Scotland was something that a lot of people were thinking, can he actually do it? But you know, listen, he wants to go and fight, he wants to scrap, he wants to have a challenge. But no, I think he's done well in the Championship. He's a good footballer, and let's say if he can have a good season next year, when obviously new manager going into Watford, then hopefully that'll progress and he can, you know, improve as a player.
Plenty applauded so far for Ryan Porteous. And Scotland have possession with Tierney, left of the three centre halves. He's played it back to the feet of Gunn. And Scotland, as Charlie mentioned, have lost a lot of caps for their goalkeepers in recent times. In fact, the substitute goalkeepers Xander Clark and Liam Kelly, neither of whom have made their senior debut for the Scotland national team. That's a foul by Christie on halfway against Melling. Not sure the referee really needed to give a free kick because Norway still had comfortable possession. Body check by Christie.
Just nothing, isn't it? just got to get on with it. But when he goes to ground there, the referee's got to make a decision. But no, it's you just got to disrupt the flow of what Norway are trying to do at the moment. Yeah. You know, they've had a lot of possession. They've, you know, had a few half chances. But if you can disrupt the flow of the game and get the crowd quiet, then it'll definitely help Scotland.
Well, the one chance of the game so far really was for Sorloth, and header straight to the goal.
Free header, he's got to do better. But anything at the other side of Angus Gunn, then it might have caused him problems. But fortunately for Scotland, it was straight on.
0-0 it remains on TalkSport 2. Scotland unbeaten in qualifying so far, 2 wins and 2 coming into today. Top of the group, Ødegaard playing it back to Berg. Norway still seeking their first victory in qualification, and Berg's ball is intercepted by the number 7, John McGinn, who'll just check back and stand on the ball and wait for Christie coming across from the right to take over. And Scotland cleverly keep possession. Robertson 10 yards shy of the halfway line. Back in field to Scott McTominay. McTominay with 2 red shirts around him, but still picks the pass forward up the middle to find a teammate in the shape of Christie again. And now Tierney on the ball midway inside his own half the field. And Scotland don't need to force the issue here. If it's a must-win for either of these two sides, it's certainly a must-win for Norway. And Scotland have done a relatively good job so far of keeping them quiet, Charlie.
Yeah, it's good. It's good from Scotland. I like that we don't want to just try and rush to go forward too early. Let's build the game and, you know, keep our short passes to try and entice Norway out of their positions, and we can try and find people in the spaces. But, you know, Hickey there getting caught with his back to goal, and unlucky there. Pass.
Orsner's trying to thread it through the middle towards Erling Haaland. For a moment, the danger was on, but it was well read by Hendry.
Yeah, it was good positional from Hendry, which is something he's good at. He's, you know, he's a good footballer, Hendry, and obviously done well in the last few seasons going to Bruges and playing abroad from leaving Celtic.
They've got it back again though here in Norway. It's Ødegaard driving forward up to the edge of the D, forward to Haaland. Haaland trying to skip away from the defender. Loose ball comes back to Ødegaard, and now Solbakken. Scotland have got white shirts right back behind the ball now. Melling from the dead ball line chips in across, far post is Sorloth, and it was an impossible angle really there to try and score. He headed it way over the top, and actually credit to Scotland, Charlie, because just as it looked the danger was on, suddenly there were 6, 7, 8 behind the ball.
Yeah, a lot of Melling again down this right hand side, clipping it to the back post. Like, he just got it all wrong, Sorloth, didn't he? He tried to head it back to the edge of the box and end up head over. But it just shows that you turn the ball over, these Norwegians, they're good technical players, they can cause you problems, find little pockets. And, you know, Scotland were lucky to get the bodies back there and close the gaps.
It is worth saying today, Scotland players wearing black armbands in memory of Gordon McQueen, who so sadly died earlier this week. And our thoughts, as I'm sure everybody's thoughts, are with his family. Steve Clark called the former international defender a giant of a man in his pre-match press conference. And a lovely touch from the Scotland players.
Yeah, it's, you know, when you lose somebody of that ilk in terms of Scotland and Leeds and Manchester United, it's a sad occasion, and everything that he's gone through. So yeah, to Haley and the family, it's, you know, the thoughts are with them, because, you know, he's an icon in Scotland for the national team. So yeah, it's a tough time, but you know, something that the national team, the boys will look to do with pride and let's say always remembered.
Absolutely. Norway in possession now with Ryerson. He's just 10 yards over halfway. Right back position. And so Angus Gunner's only been tested once so far in the first 30 and a half minutes. The Norway fans all around the lower tiers of the stadium are up on their feet and clapping and cheering. A lot of red shirts being worn by the Norway supporters. Their team are certainly playing or trying to play with energy and purpose. There's no lack of commitment and at times some decent football from Norway, but no great incisiveness in the final third yet.
No, I just don't think that the intensity is really there yet. I think, listen, the weather could be playing a part in it, but you know, Norway have passed it round well enough, but without really creating too much.
Here is Ødegaard again on the edge of the D, shooting low. It's well blocked by Porteous, who had to send it quickly back to the goalkeeper. You can see Ødegaard, every time he drives in field onto that left-hand side, he's always looking to shoot, and Scotland are aware of that. And Porteous got in front of the ball to make an important block.
Yeah, good. Let's say it again, Ødegaard picking up in that spaces again. But Scotland now, Norway looking to hit Sorlot on that diagonal above Robertson and trying to get the knockdowns for Ødegaard, picking up little spaces. So, you know, it's important that we stop at a source and we get closer to Berg or to Ødegaard at the back, who are hitting their passes.
Georgia in third place in the group. Travel to Cyprus later, so potentially Scotland, if they were to win today, would go at least for a couple of hours 8 points clear of third place. Remember, the top two in the group qualify for Euro 2024, so there could be a considerable cushion for Scotland by the end of today. We will see.
The big opportunity.
Yeah.
Big opportunity tonight if you can get a win here to really put a gap between you and Norway. And if you do that, then obviously the big game's coming up, but you know, you have to just focus on this game and hope for... Oh, what a ball from Robertson.
Really good cross from Andy Robertson into that little corridor of uncertainty, edge of the six-yard box, but Dykes couldn't get anything on it. It's behind for a goal kick.
No, I think Stranderbelt just blocked his run, but Robertson again with a lovely left foot, delivery out the side, and just put it in that... just in that corridor where you just, as a goalkeeper, can't come for it. Defender doesn't really want to slide for it, because if he stretches, it might go for an own goal. But Dykes has got to read that better. He's got to try and get freer and at least get a chance at hitting the target.
Steve Clark patrolling his technical area, the man who guided Scotland to their first major tournament for 23 years. And a defeat in the playoff semi-finals for the 2022 World Cup. But to have Scotland in the position where they might qualify for a second major tournament in three would be very impressive indeed.
Yeah, because it's been so long before that we've been to a major tournament, and when you get that one over the line, you get the hunger and the bug to go again. And if we can qualify for Germany, yeah, it would be brilliant. We weren't disgraced really in terms of the Euros, but you know, we know that we can do better in the games.
Nice clearance by the goalkeeper Nieland, right in front of the Scotland fans, and they enjoyed that behind the goal. And it's a throw to Scotland about 6 yards from the corner flag. The goalkeeper had to come out to the edge of his penalty area and was looking up into the sun. He sliced it off his left boot. And what can Scotland do here as Ryan Porteous comes forward to hurl in one of those long throws, it looks like.
And again, from nothing, Nieland comes racing out, goes to kick it with his left foot and puts it for a throw-in. So a little bit of pressure here now for Norway to defend with Scotland.
Porteous has taken the throw short in the end to Christie. Peels away on the edge of the penalty area. Deep ball to the far post. Robertson is there. John McGinn with a snapshot, and it's blocked by Strandberg. It was goal-bound. It was hit well, but the Norway defender got in front
of
it.
Yeah, brilliant from Scotland. Something they look like they've worked on. A little bit of block for Hickey there. Christie just hanging up to the back post. Tierney getting round the back, and what a good strike from McGinn, and a block there from Strandberg. But positive play from Scotland.
That's the best they've created so far. And McGinn's shot would have been tough for Nieland to handle had it been on target. Blocked by Strandberg at the vital moment, and it's a Scotland throw. 10 yards from the corner flag, long into the penalty area from Tierney, headed away by Sorlot, only as far as McTominay. Now Hickey of Brentford laying it square to McGregor, out to McGinn again on the far side, the left. Lovely back heel by McGregor towards Tierney, just enough on the interception though from Ryerson to clear it away for Norway. Scotland showing that they are capable of playing some good incisive football in the final third, and it's a warning or a message to Norway anyway that
They're not going to have it all their own.
Yeah, good positive play. Two midfielders up on the play and trying to force the game. McTominay and McGregor there, forcing the back heel never there. But no, a little bit more positive from Scotland, getting into that Norway half and into the box.
35 minutes, Norway nil, Scotland nil. It remains, whatever happens at the end of today, Scotland will be clear at the top of the group. Spain, who start the day second, are not playing this qualifying week. And Cyprus and Georgia, we mentioned, head to head later on. Norway with just a single point from their two games so far, and it really does feel like a must win for them. Albeit Stada Solbakken has said if they do get the win, it really does drag Spain and Scotland into that slight uncertainty and put them in a little bit of discomfort in the group. Scotland, though, want to throw midway inside Spain territory, Charlie Adam.
Yeah, I think Steve will be happy in terms of where they're at, not really giving much away. I think, can we do more with the ball? Yes. I think we can have a little bit more composure and have that little bit of an extra pass before we really force it. But away from home performance, you've got to be real happy.
The flower of Scotland echoing around the arena. Long ball forward by Tierney up towards Robertson. He's down by the corner flag. He's dispossessed by Ryerson. Wanted a free kick. The Scotland captain doesn't get it from the referee. Now they can break Norway with Ødegaard. Midway inside his own half. Checks back and plays it backwards. Tripped by McGinn. I don't think it's a... Well, McGinn is going to get yellow carded here. I was going to say it seemed a very innocuous foul, but the referee says it's worthy of a yellow card.
It's a foul. It's just silly play from McGinn. He just leaves it one on Ødegaard for no reason, doesn't need to do it, and he deserves the booking. It's lack of discipline, that. Just leaving it on Ødegaard just for no reason. The ball's going nowhere, he's facing his own goal, and he just clips him and he goes down. And yeah, I think it's a booking because, you know, you're getting frustrated. McGinn's getting frustrated because he's not getting much of the ball, and Scotland, when they do have it, are not penetrating with it enough.
And so John McGinn is booked and walking that proverbial tightrope for the rest of the game. Only 38 minutes in. Norway nil, Scotland nil. It's TalkSport 2. Opportunity for Sorlot. Right-hand edge of the penalty area. Dispossessed by Robertson, who charges in between two red shirts and plays a lovely ball forward to McTominay. McTominay driving over the halfway line. He's got options to his right and to his left. McTominay's carried it very far forward, and he's tackled by Ødegaard, and McTominay surely should have let go of the pass, Charlie, a bit earlier.
Yeah, he done brilliant to drive past the two midfielders, and there was an opportunity just to slip in Lyndon Dykes, but he chose to keep going himself and eventually run out of room. But no, positive from McGinn, from McTominay, going and opening their legs. He's got big stride, you know, something that he's good at, and that's what he gives you when he's playing in that midfield. But he could have played that pass a little bit earlier.
Scotland, of course, desperately hoping they'll be in Germany for the Euros next summer. TalkSport and TalkSport 2 will be there. More live football on the radio than anybody else next season.
The Euros need Scotland.
Well, they need the Tartan Army.
Yeah,
don't
they need the support. It's they go there, they enjoy themselves, and they bring a lot of supporters as well. So it'd be good if we can get there and be part of, you know, which is normally a brilliant occasion.
Well, you and I were saying earlier, Charlie, that I think particularly given how the Euros went in 2021 with the crowd situation, as McGinn wins a free kick inside his own half, Scotland didn't have the crowd numbers that the team will have felt they deserved and merited after the qualifying campaign, but it will have had an effect on results, won't it, as well? Because you can imagine things might have been very different with a Hampden full of Scotland supporters.
And especially in that Croatia game, you know, Modric, he run the show. It was one of the best performances I've seen from Luka Modric. He was incredible that day. But yeah, when that moment come when Scotland could have, you know, nearly scored, and the opportunity they had would have definitely been helped with the Tartan Army there. And hopefully, let's say, if we can get to that position in Germany again, there'll be, you know, many thousands of Scotland fans going to watch them.
That's a foul on Haaland, surely on the halfway line by Hendry it is, and it's going to be a yellow card for the Scotland defender. Haaland not happy, his arms outstretched, he appeals to the referee. I mean, there wasn't really any other decision to make, surely, other than a yellow, because Haaland was on the halfway line, he was so far away from goal. But you can see why he's upset with the challenge.
Absolutely, because he's felt that he can go, but that's what he can do, he could pin you, you know, and Hendry got caught goal side, and, you know, could nearly have cost his team there, but you know, good play from Haaland, good centre forward play, backing in and making Henry foul him.
Well, he's wrestled Haaland to the ground. It was a cynical challenge, but I think the referee's got the decision right, because there was such a long way for even a player of Haaland's quality to
hit. He would never have got onto the next pass, but like you say, what Scotland, maybe that the line was too high and that pass was on, so Scotland will have to be wary of that.
4.5 minutes of the first half to go. That's a poor ball forward up the inside left channel with his right boot by Ostergaard. And straight out of play it goes for a goal kick to Scotland, who have coped well in quite a raucous atmosphere at the full Ullevål Stadium. On a warm day as well, we have to say, very warm for Norway, 28 degrees.
I think it seems to be warm all over the world at the moment. You know, Scotland, England, Norway. I think the weather's been brilliant so far this summer, and hopefully long may it continue.
Here is Haaland on the halfway line. He's surrounded by three in white there, Erling Haaland, and he hasn't been able to affect the game at all.
No, he's not really had much chance. Nothing really been playing up to him where he can go and hold it, apart from that there with Henry. But, you know, he's been not really been in the game. So, let's say, as long as we can keep him quiet, then it'll give us definitely a better chance of getting something out of this match.
And sometimes, of course, easier said than done. But, with all due respect, and there's a lot of talent in this Norway squad, Haaland hasn't quite got certainly the number of providers that he has at Manchester City, of course.
It's a different quality player in that Man City team to what they have in Norway. And, you know, at times he might just be feeding off scraps, but give him half a chance, and it falls to him, then you would expect him. Like, now,
Hendry's back header was a risky one, and it's trickled through to Angus Gunn, and he gets the applause from Tierney, does Hendry. He did try to header it back to the goalkeeper away from goal itself, and Gunn just had enough on it to reach the goalkeeper ahead of Haaland.
Yeah, his heart would have been in his mouth there, really. Henry, just, he might have thought he got it wrong, but, you know, Angus Gunn reacts well. But going back to Haaland, yeah, he's not really had much in the game, but give him half a chance and he'll be the one that can stick it in the back of the net and take the game away from you. So always got to be prepared physically, mentally, be switched on for Scotland.
Angus Gunn, a former Manchester City goalkeeper. Norway fans are bouncing up and down in the stands. Some of them are doing the Poznan, which Haaland will be very familiar with after Manchester City's treble exploits over the last 3 weeks. Amazing few weeks that they've had.
Yeah, listen, they're the best team in the world at the moment. You know, what they've done, performances in that Premier League, FA Cup, and then in the Champions League was phenomenal, and you know, thoroughly deserve to enjoy it, and they have over the last few weeks. But back to work this week internationally, and then they'll have a few weeks off and then go back again to try and win it all again. And that's what football does. It's a conveyor belt. You get off it and then you'll get back straight back on it in a few weeks and prepare ready to have another 50-60 game season.
Here's a relentless schedule. The former Scotland midfielder Charlie Adam alongside me on TalkSport 2. 26 caps for the national team for Charlie, who worked under Steve Clarke when he was assistant manager at Liverpool. And Steve Clarke, I'm sure, will be relatively pleased with what he's seen from Scotland so far. But there might be danger here with Ødegaard laying the ball to the right-hand side, and Sorloth, he's level the edge of the penalty area. 44th minute, 0-0. Good interception initially by McGinn, and then Callum McGregor came across and used his experience there to win Scotland a throw.
Yeah, he felt that he should have had the foul earlier, man, but he reacted well, positive, going and getting it back, and that's what Callum does. Goes and picks up the pieces there and gets Scotland a throw in a, you know, take a little bit of pressure off the team.
And actually, Charlie, we talk about the treble for Erling Haaland. It's five domestic trebles now for Callum McGregor at Celtic.
Yeah, I think if you talk about what he's achieved at Celtic, and it looks like Brendan's obviously going to go back, which, you know, we I think we're going to talk about it. It's that, you know, he's been there a long time, coming through the ranks. He's had to go on loan to Notts County, but he's gone in there and got his opportunity, and he's been an unbelievable captain for Celtic. The conveyor belt of trophies just keeps coming for them, and they're building teams all the time. And yeah, listen, they were phenomenal last season.
The ball is deep inside Norway territory. Ryerson plays it back to the goalkeeper Nieland, who hasn't had a serious save to make really, though. Well, neither has Gunn, albeit Sorloth should have done better with his headed chance. A minute of added time at the end of the first half on TalkSport 2. They've got the floodlights on here in Oslo, not that they really need them. Christie left on the edge of the penalty area, He's held it up well in front of the defender Strandberg. Plays it back to Andy Robertson. Robertson delivers towards Lyndon Dykes. Headed away by Ostergaard. Had to make that header firm and clear to nod it away from danger.
Yeah, good play from Robertson. Good cross. Dykes nearly gets on the end of it. Gets crossed Ostergaard, but good defending from the defender. And, you know, listen, it's at half-time. 0-0. Steve will be happy, but, you know, things that we have to work on in terms of keeping the ball better. Can we be a little bit more positive? You know, and being more aggressive in terms of going and pressing the game and putting Norway under a little bit more pressure.
The ball is staying upfield by Berg. Tattoos down his arms, the number six for Norway, but he's giving it away. Scotland have it back again, finishing the half the stronger. We've just about had the minutes of added time. And right on cue, that is the half-time whistle, and a satisfactory first 45 minutes for Scotland, you would think. I think there were one or two boos there from the Norway supporters. Norway, with Erling Haaland and Martin Ødegaard in their ranks, have really struggled to create much against a very disciplined Scotland side. It's been an impressive defensive rearguard so far for Steve Clark's team. At the other end, Scotland got themselves into one convincing position late in the first period, but John McGinn's shot was blocked. Andy Robertson just having words with the referee as the players leave the field. Half time on TalkSport 2. It is Norway 0, Scotland 0, and Scotland, you would think, will be the happier, Charlie.
Yeah, I think you're positive in terms of it's 0-0, clean sheet. Only really one chance that Norway have had, but, you know, we can still think Scotland could play better. I think we can be better in possession with the ball and maybe just have that extra little pass to try and entice Norway out. But overall, 0-0 away from home, yeah, decent enough performance.
I think we pinpointed, didn't we, Charlie, particularly in and around that Sorloth chance, and he probably should have done better with it, that there is a potent aerial threat that Norway have got, and that chance, I guess, was just a reminder for Scotland of that.
Yeah, absolutely. I look at Norway, the height that they have, they're a big side, and you know, Mellin gets down the left hand side and chips over to Sorloth, and he gets up and free header, really. He should have scored, should have done better, but it was straight Angus gone, which was good for Scotland. So there's one or two opportunities down that right hand side between Hickey and Portis has caused us problems. So if we don't, you know, react to that, or maybe the distances are too big between the two of them and they're allowing opportunities, then if Steve could sort that at half time, then Scotland will be positive for second half. But not really much in the game, I don't think, either with both teams.
Is there something in this for Scotland going forward? We haven't seen them create too much so far.
No, but I think that is Scotland. You know, we don't really create too much, but we'll go and win games. You know, you might nick it a 1-0 and get the result. So long as we stay in the game and we feel that, you know, comfortable enough in that first half, yeah, Norway have a lot of possession, but not really doing enough, not getting Ødegaard on the ball enough that can cause you problems. So we have to watch that, because once he starts getting in positions where it could cause you problems, then he's obviously a dangerous player. So, you know, Scotland have to try and nullify him as much as we can, and if we stop supply to Ødegaard, then it'll definitely stop the supply to Haaland.
Ødegaard has probably received the ball just two or three times in that menacing position that he takes up when he drives infield onto his left foot about 25 yards out. He hasn't been able to test Angus Gunn just yet. Haaland had that one opportunity where he was fouled by Hendry, but again, when you look at it in the first half, Scotland have kept those two key players quiet.
Yeah, and that's what you have to do to try and, because that's their connection. They'll look to try and play together. They've obviously got a good relationship on the pitch, and you know, Henry got a book in there because he got too tight to Haaland, you know, on the halfway line. And it was a book in. Haaland would never have got to the pass, but, you know, it's something that Scotland have to be wary of. You know, Henry there too deep, you know, pushed really, really high up and allowed Haaland to get his body in and then cause the problems, and he was just marking the wrong side. But fortunately for Scotland, it was only a yellow card.
And Charlie Adam with us for commentary this afternoon from Oslo. Much more from Charlie to come at half time. We'll discuss Brendan Rodgers' return to Celtic, his imminent return, it looks like, and the midfield merry-go-round. All sorts of summer transfer rumours being dominated by midfielders. We'll get Charlie's thoughts on those ahead of the second half here at the Ullevaal Stadium at half time in this crucial Euro 2024 qualifier on TalkSport 2. It is Norway 0, Scotland 0.
High fidelity radio coverage.
Oh, there's a Henry team!
The Euro 2024 qualifiers live on TalkSport 2.
Make sure you kick off every Saturday and Sunday morning with a weekend sports breakfast on Talksport with the Sun. Join Natalie Sawyer and Tony Cascarino for all the latest news, essential previews, expert insight, exclusive interviews, and everything you need to make sure you're ahead of the game.
You better believe it!
The Weekend Sports Breakfast, this Saturday morning from 6 on Talksport with the Sun.
Oh, it's absolutely magnificent!
Follow all the match action and breaking news on the Sun Live blogs. Visit thesun.co.uk.
If you're looking to trim your spending, checking for subscriptions that you no longer need could be an easy win. The Barclays app makes it simple. You can view your subscriptions and upcoming payments in one place, helping you to manage your spending. You might even spot some other savings you can make right now too. For more money help, search Barclays Cost of Living. Barclays, make money work for you. You need to be 11 or over to access this product or service using the app. T's and C's apply.
Did you know that if you owned or leased a diesel vehicle between 2009 and 2020, then you could be entitled to significant compensation? At My Diesel Claim, we're experts in handling these claims, and over a million drivers have already trusted us to represent them in their no-win, no-fee claims. It's completely free to sign up, and you can check your vehicle's eligibility instantly. Head to mydieselclaim.com and join thousands of others starting their claims today.
It's the All-Star Stat Centre. Stat Guru Sarah, tell us about Nissan's All-Star lineup of vans.
Well, the Interstar moves up to 1.5 tonnes of cargo. The Prima Star has a crew version for your full squad. And the 100% electric Townstar EV gives up to 183 miles of range. All covered by a 5-year warranty.
That's All-Star quality. Search Nissan All-Star Vans and find out more.
Range based on L1 Vizia grade. WLTP figures quoted for comparability purposes. Actual real-world driving results may vary. Warranty T's and C's apply.
This Father's Day, say thanks for all the love, laughs and embarrassing dad jokes with a gift from M&S. Choose from grooming kits, hampers and outfits with style, even matching looks for his mini-me. Whatever your dad's into, you'll find something he'll love. And don't forget, it's on Sunday the 18th of June. Shop in store or at marksandspencer.com.
Captivating coverage.
Brilliant football.
The Euro 2024 qualifiers live on TalkSport 2.
And half-time in Oslo, Norway 0, Scotland 0, the latest score. This is Joe Shannon live on TalkSport 2, the former Scotland midfielder Charlie Adam alongside me. So as it stands, Scotland would start the group campaign 3 unbeaten. They'd be on 7 points from 3 matches, and of course they would not only retain their lead at the top, but they would extend it, move another point clear of Spain in second. Norway, as it stands, heading for just 2 points from their opening 3 group games. Second half commentary to come on TalkSport 2 at a warm and sunny Ullevål Stadion. Brendan Rodgers, of course, widely rumoured to be returning to Celtic. Dermot Desmond, we're hearing, wants to bring the Northern Irishman back to Parkhead. Rodgers has a 5-year plan to transform Celtic. Of course, Charlie, everybody's well aware of the success that Brendan Rodgers had at that club. Some people say, you know, once you've been there, you never go back. But actually, this appears to be a situation which may work out ideally for all parties.
Yeah, absolutely. I think a lot of supporters will be disappointed in terms of how Brendan left the football club. But if Celtic can get a manager of Brendan Rodgers' quality back to the football club, listen, they have an owner who, you know, money is not an issue for them. Then if they could afford to go bring Brendan back, and by all accounts it's nearly done, then I think this is a top-class manager. I think he's a top manager, and it's a big statement from Celtic. I think after winning a domestic treble last year, Ange leaving, going to Tottenham, I think it's the perfect manager to come back into the building to try and keep grasp of the three trophies, because Rangers, they've strengthened. Michael's obviously brought in a few players early in the window as well for pre-season, and maybe that's something that Celtic will have to be wary of what they want to try and bring in the building as well in the next few weeks. So I think if they can get the Brendan Rodgers deal over the line, then I think it's a huge statement from Celtic.
Well, it's been interesting, hasn't it, seeing some of the flashbacks, some of those banners that we saw at Parkhead after Brendan Rodgers left Celtic at the end of his first spell to go to Leicester City, and the frustration of the supporters at the time. But you get the sense, really, that
if he comes in and he delivers results, that the matter of his departure will quickly be forgotten and attention will turn back to the success that he did have at the club.
Absolutely. Celtic supporters will be singing Brendan Rodgers' name within the first six games of the season. It's what football does. It's what that manager will do. He'll win you football matches and it'll all be forgotten. At the time, yes, it hurt them because, you know, fans think that it's only their club and they only think about their club, and Brendan was saying all the right things about Celtic staying there and wanting to, but it's difficult to turn the Premier League down. He felt there was the right opportunity for him to go to Leicester, like Ange thinks it's the right opportunity to go to Tottenham. But if Brendan comes back into the building, then, you know, if they're winning football matches, then they'll be singing his name again and he'll be a hero like he was just before he left.
And what would Celtic, and what I guess would Brendan Rodgers as an individual deem as success? Do we have to talk about European progress for Celtic next season?
I think
as well?
So. I think you have to. I think progress in the Champions League has got to be a must, but the reports are that he'll have a decent enough pot of money to go and spend and buy players and improve quality. I think you'll look to listen, the two teams, Rangers Celtic, will win, you know, probably
the
most
big prizes.
The big prizes in Scotland. There's no doubt about that. But so I think it'd be more for the European side for Celtic and for Brendan, how he can improve the team, how he can make them better. And that was one of the things that they'd never done when they lost 10 in a row, was that they never improved the team the way that he probably thought they could have and should have to stop it. But you know, he's been there 3 or 4 years away from the club. He's coming back now. Celtic's in a very healthy position. I think it's more on the European side if they can go and compete and be, you know, better in the Champions League, but also can they go to the latter stages like Rangers have in previous years of going to the Europa League if they do fall out of the Champions League. But being in the Champions League regular is a must.
We'll stay with TalkSport and TalkSport 2 for the latest on Brendan Rodgers' impending move to Celtic. This summer's transfer rumours are being dominated by midfielders up to this point. Declan Rice, of course, widely linked with a £100 million move for Arsenal. We know that Jude Bellingham has moved for more than £100 million to join Real Madrid. Ilkay Gundogan is available. Moises Caicedo rapidly being linked with Chelsea. And Liverpool are an interesting one, your former club, Charlie, because, of course, people often pinpointed their midfield as being the cause of their downfall last season. We've just seen Trent Alexander-Arnold star in a midfield position again, this time for England. Could he be the solution to some of Liverpool's midfield problems without them having to go and get more midfield players?
I think they will go and get more midfielders, but it does give them an opportunity to bring Trent into that midfield position on a full-time basis. You've seen at times he started to do that in the back end of the season. His numbers were brilliant in there, go from assists and things like that. So listen, I said all the time, he's the best passer in the football club. He could see a pass, any pass Trent can play. So then that opens an avenue. Does then that mean that Liverpool have to go and buy a right back, which I think they will have to then if Trent's going to play there in full time? So then does that allow Kyle Walker, possibly, who looks like reports that he can leave Manchester City? So I just think that if Kyle Walker become available for Liverpool, I think it'd be one that they would have to try and get, because, you know, still at, you know, top shape, top form, you know, seen that over the last last season performances that he had. So I think if they can get Trent into midfield, it's something that they'll look at. But also I do think that they'll go and try and bring some more midfielders in because of, you know, Jordan, the age of Jordan, Thiago is not fully fit, Keita's gone, Milner's gone, Chamberlain gone.
So
there's room for another midfielder. Alexis McAllister has been a brilliant signing, so will be a brilliant signing.
Well, speaking of Trent Alexander-Arnold, TalkSport's Tony Cascarino has his doubts as to whether Trent has the ability to play in the middle of the park against the very best in the world.
There's a strange sort of set of circumstances that, because you do it against Malta, you know, and everyone thinks, well, will he get the chance, you know, if you're playing Germany in a quarterfinal game or ever in a World Cup match, Argentina, Brazil, would you still play Trent in there? Now, this is what I go back to, because they would play him. Now, we all know that they would. You know, Lionel Messi spent most of the World Cup walking around, and yet when he got it, now, am I comparing Trent to Lionel Messi? No, but he's got qualities that ain't far off him. And can he improve in that position? We're all looking at Trent and thinking, well, that's what we know he can do. Can he improve on that?
We'll see Tony Cascarino on Trent Alexander-Arnold live every Saturday and Sunday morning between 6 and 10 for Weekend Sports Breakfast on Talk Sport alongside Natalie Sawyer. Is that a concern? His ability to be able to translate that form from an England international, be it one in Malta, to potentially playing in that position week on week out in the Premier League for Liverpool?
Well, there's no Lionel Messi, is he? You know, I think he can go and play midfield in the English Premier League. There's no doubt about it. Against the best players, he's physically can do it. You know, technically he can do it. So why can't he? I think that, you know, he has to obviously have to understand the position a little bit more and be more disciplined. But if he's going to play there, maybe in a two or as in a three in midfield, I think Trent Alexander could play in that midfield position without a doubt.
Much more to come across the course of the summer transfer window, and as always, TalkSport and TalkSport.com, the place to be for all the latest transfer news, of course, on your radio or indeed online. We'll have all the very latest breaking stories for you as and when they happen. Lots more live football to come on the TalkSport network. England against North Macedonia in the Euros qualifying campaign. Commentary from Jim Proudfoot and the former England defender Stuart Pearce at Old Trafford on TalkSport Monday night at 7:45. At the same time on TalkSport 2, Turkey against Wales. Tuesday, we've got racing from Royal Ascot for you. Thursday, Super League live on TalkSport 2, Hull FC against St Helens. And on Saturday and Sunday, PGA Tour live, the Travellers Championship. That is live on TalkSport 2. Lots of football over the course of the summer and lots of summer sport for you as well before we start the new Premier League campaign, and it'll be live and exclusive. 110 Premier League commentaries for you exclusively on the TalkSport network to come this season. We are about to get back underway in Oslo. Scotland have kicked us off, playing from right to left in the second half, all in white with blue trim. Norway, red shirts, dark blue shorts and socks, playing from left to right. The sun is shining in Norway, and Scotland 0-0 against a side who desperately need a win in their campaign. Scotland, as it stands, heading for 3 unbeaten in Group A. They will stay top of the table. They've kept Norway and Erling Haaland pretty quiet so far. Scotland have won an early free kick just inside opposition territory, and Charlie Adam, more of the same, the message from Steve Clarke?
Yeah, just a little bit more care in that final forward area to really try and open Norway up if we can. You know, a little bit more simpler and see if we can do something there. But it's same team, you know, no subs yet. So Steve's got a bit of ammunition on the bench. Yeah, a couple of lads and Nesbitt and Shankland who have scored a few goals this season. So looks like maybe one of them may get an opportunity, hopefully in the back end of the match.
Absolutely. And no changes, as you say, at half-time for either team. Gunn is the Scotland goalkeeper. Opportunity for Norway here down the right with Sorloth. He's got away from Andy Robertson. He's played it back in field to Ødegaard. Ødegaard midway into the Scotland half. He's drifted across from right to left. Plays the ball to the feet of Melling. And now Solbakken. Back to Berg. And Norway have it on the halfway line. Scotland with Porteous, Hendry and Tierney at centre half. Hickey and Robertson, the wing-backs, McTominay and McGregor sitting in front of them. McGinn and Christie trying to get forward in support of Lyndon Dykes through the middle. I'll give the Scotland bench in a moment, but here come Norway. Opportunity from the edge of the box and a simple save for Angus Gunn. Low to his left to deny Ola Solbakken. The shot didn't really have any power whatsoever behind it. It was a save that you'd easily expect the goalkeeper to make.
Yeah, good play there from Norway. Ball wrapped in from Ødegaard right into Haaland's feet. Controlled it brilliantly. Played into Solbakken, and then he just Solbakken, sorry, and he plays into Angus Gunn. But you know, if I'm Haaland, I've got a nice early touch. Gives me a little bit of confidence because he never really had much of a kick first half. So you know, Scotland will have to make sure they don't get too tight to Haaland, because if you do, then he could roll you.
Norway with Nyland in goal, Ryerson, Strandberg, Ødegaard, and Melling the defenders. And Ødegaard, Berg, and Arsnes in midfield. Sorloth, Solbakken, and Haaland are the front three. Scotland have the ball with Callum McGregor on the halfway line, playing it back now to
Porteous. Porteous with a good ball infield to McGinn. Spins away from his man. 25 yards out. John McGinn shoots. And it's straight to the goalkeeper, who's able to claim with the second attempt. Lovely bit of skill initially from McGinn. And his shot in the end, well, it didn't have too much power on it. And a relatively simple save.
Yeah, brilliant from Porteous. Love that pass from him on. You know, stepping in, playing opposite pocket. McGinn getting on the half turn and just driving away from Bergen and having that shot on target and, you know, getting a bit of confidence. But that's where McGinn's dangerous, you know, in that middle of the pitch where he can get on the turn and get his shots off.
Scotland, that bench, Clark and Kelly, the goalkeepers, Cooper, Patterson, Hyam and Taylor. Norway on the attack with Ødegaard. He looked to thread it through the middle towards Haaland. It was well intercepted by Kieran Tierney, and Scotland have it back. Stuart Armstrong, Gilmore, Ferguson, Jack McLean, and the two strikers that Charlie mentioned, Lawrence Shankland, who had such an outstanding season at Hearts, and Kevin Nisbet, who has just joined Millwall from Hibs this summer. The other two on the bench. Dykes now setting up Ryan Christie, racing down the right hand side. He's into the penalty area. Christie, the angle is very tight. McGinn waiting for the pullback on the edge of the box. It's Ostergaard who got a foot in. Dykes had gone down earlier in the move, and he's still down here as Scotland win a corner, 0-0.
Yeah, good play there from Dykes, you know, getting in a fight there with Ostergaard. He beats him there, and Christie driving, you know, running beyond, getting up the pitch and getting a corner for Scotland.
Terrific play from Ryan Christie, who's been a regular for Bournemouth again, hasn't scored for Scotland since September of 2022. And threaten here from a set play. It's a little more open this start to the second half. We are 4.5 minutes into the second period on TalkSport 2, and a corner for Scotland at the home end of the ground. They're playing from right to left in this second half. It's bathed in shade, that home end behind the goal. Now an opportunity for McGinn after the corner was taken short. It's a poor layoff back towards Christie with his back to goal. Melling will drive the ball clear, high left footed over the halfway line. Saul back and trying to bring it down. He can't get away from McTominay, albeit the loose ball is dropped towards Haaland, and Haaland was tripped by McTominay right in front of the referee, and a free kick to Norway. I think it was an accidental trip more than anything, but the right decision made by Matthew.
Just show what he's got, the strength he's got. He holds off two or three players there. Porteous just giving them a little nibble just to give him, you know, to knock him off his feet. But going again there from that, comes from Scotland set play, you know, switching off in terms of trying to play a short one, not people not doing the jobs properly, and all of a sudden this long ball straight up the pitch, and all of a sudden now Norway have a chance to put it in our box.
And then it remains. Norway free kick, whipped in by Ødegaard, high left footed, free header, Ostergaard hits it wide. Scotland look for the flag that I think has now gone up, so it wouldn't have counted anyway. But a reminder of that aerial threat that Norway have got.
Yeah, the quality of Ødegaard, but great line from Scotland. You know, good, just high line, allowing the, you know, space in behind for Gunn if he wanted to come for a bit. No, good line, read it well, and you know, Ostergaard was offside, but just shows the danger that the Scotland have got from their own set plays, that how quick that Norway can attack, and when you've got Haaland who can hold up for you, gives other people a chance to get into the game.
Wander of a left foot from Ødegaard, so precocious from those dead balls. Strandberg has sliced the ball out of play for Norway. How Scotland would love the cushion of a lead here in Oslo, and especially if they could take a victory into the game with Georgia on Tuesday night at Hampden. It'd be the possibility of 4 wins from 4 to start the campaign, but it's 0-0 here in Norway at the moment, headed behind by Dykes, out of play, goal kick. I wonder how long Steve Clark might leave it before he thinks about changes, Charlie Adams.
Yeah, I would expect quite early in the second half, but, you know, Norway manager said that we have to win the match. You know, we're under pressure, we have to win the match. So next 10-15 minutes you probably see Norway starting to take a little bit more risks, and we have to be ready to counter attack that and make sure that we're ready to take the opportunity if we get one.
Larsen, the first down the right, the near side, and he's fouled by Tierney right in front of the Norway dugout. Tierney and Robertson helping each other out, and Larsen has got a hole in his blue sock now. Tierney can't believe it. The yellow card out of the pocket of the referee.
I think it's a foul, is it?
Not much in it.
Yeah, but I think it's the reaction he gets the booking for. You know, yeah, the referee's saying he's throwing his hands in the air, he doesn't like that, so that's what that yellow card was for.
There's a little bit of speculation that he might leave Arsenal this summer, Kieran Tierney, of course.
Yeah.
Zinchenko's played a lot of football, Charlie, in his position.
Yeah, he has, and done well, but I still think Kieran Tierney is a better footballer than Zinchenko and deserves an opportunity. But you know, Mikel sees what he sees. He brought him in from Manchester City, and he done well in parts of the season. So I would like them to stay at Arsenal. But if he's not getting game time, listen, there'll be plenty of suitors out there for Kieran Tierney in the summer if he has to move on from Arsenal.
Ball's on the halfway line, and Melling will take a throw for Norway, the far side. A full stadium today. This is Norway's main home ground. They're back here on Tuesday against Cyprus. And Norway, who last graced a major tournament in the year 2000, they have lost in the playoffs for both World Cups and European Championships on quite a few occasions since, and almost illustrating the point that you made earlier on, Charlie, earlier on in the commentary, it is really hard to qualify for these major tournaments.
It is, and the longer you don't qualify, the harder it becomes. But you know, I think this Nations League thing helps you as well. You know, Scotland have got that cushion that they've already made the playoffs in terms of if winning their own group. So if we can do it this way, they'd be brilliant as well. But you know you've got that cushion. So Norway have to, you know, this group of players look like it's probably been the best generation for a little bit of a while now for Norway, and they've got quality players, you know, all over the pitch. If you look at the squad that they have, the teams that they're playing for, then there's no doubt they'd expect to be doing better than they are.
Ryerson's cross just then was a poor one, easily taken by Angus Gunn in bright yellow, right in front of the Tartan army behind the goal, about 1,300 of them on their feet to the right, and plenty enjoying the sun and topping up the tan.
Oh yeah, absolutely. You know, it's a hot day, and you know, they'll enjoy it.
And rightly so.
Oh, absolutely. When you go away on their trips, you've got to go and enjoy it and opportunities, you know, especially with the way Scotland are playing at the moment. You're going with full of confidence as a supporter that, you know, they can win football matches.
A long weekend in Oslo for many, I'm sure. Here is Berg over the halfway line for Norway. He's skipped beyond Porteous, had to check his run slightly. Opportunity for Solbakken in the left wing position. He's got Arsnes flying forward on the overlap, but forced to go back towards halfway now, and Melling, the number five. Square ball infield where Strandberg is waiting. We're 10 minutes into the second half on TalkSport 2. It has opened up a little. Norway 0, Scotland 0. The score remains. Ryerson out to Ødegaard, who is trying to dictate play. Ball threaded infield to Haaland. Lovely close control. Edge of the D. Haaland onto that favoured left foot. Now, was he fouled by Hendry? Referee says play on. And then after Hickey made a tackle, it's lashed over the top by Melling. Norway fans and players furious with the referee. They wanted a penalty kick. Nothing given.
Yeah, good play again from Ødegaard, getting that space. But Haaland is brilliant. He probably could have got shot away in the end, but tried to get that extra touch. I don't think it's a foul. But, you know, it just shows to give that opportunity to Haaland. You know, he's looking to get that shot off.
I think it would have been a very harsh penalty. Both had hold of each other, really.
Yeah. I think he could have, at least on one part of that, he could have got his shot off early enough to test Angus Gunn, but he wanted to take that extra touch. But Ødegaard, when he gets his head up and he can get, you know, play a pass, you can see the pass that he can make.
The speed and of thought and close control from Haaland there from almost nothing.
Yeah, listen, the two top players, and you know, are they world class players? Absolutely. You know, Ødegaard's played for Real Madrid, he's, you know, he's a top player, so they have a real good connection together. But Scotland can't afford, you know, to allow Ødegaard to start, you know, dictating the game and picking up little spaces, because he can hurt you.
And Nealon, the goalkeeper in bright green, has the ball. It's his left footed clearance high up towards the halfway line, but easy for Scotland in the shape of McTominay to outmuscle Solbakken, and Scotland in their white change kit have it back. It's Tierney's raking ball up the inside left channel, hit more in hope than expectation. Dykes an isolated figure, and it's straight through to the goalkeeper.
Yeah, you need more people to angle and body instead of just wanting to run away all the time. At times you need somebody to come and show, and they can link the play there, because there's an opportunity to try and build from Tierney. All of a sudden, he tried to play one down the channel, and it goes straight through to the goalkeeper.
England against North Macedonia, live on Monday night on TalkSport. Turkey against Wales on TalkSport 2. Both of those Euro 2024 qualifiers. It's an opportunity for Robertson. It's through the legs of the defender. He's into the penalty area. The angle is tight. Pulls it back across and Strandberg slides in with a great interception. It was wonderful play from Andy Robertson. No space to move into, but he turned on a sixpence through the legs of the defender and the cross turned away at the near post.
Yes, Andy Robertson at his best, going, taking people on, being inventful, and he goes by the defender, no problem. Bergen and Reiser's there, but I think he could have picked the opposite chance. I think he could have played it back to the edge of the box where there was somebody, but good positive play from the fullback.
Much more like it from Scotland and their skipper. It does feel maybe, Charlie, that there were little pockets of space in the game in the second half that weren't there in the first.
No, and that's why, let's say Norway, they feel like they have to win the match to try and really make a statement in this group. But you know, that means then somebody's going to have to open up and might somebody switch off or whatever, and that'll give Scotland the spaces to go and play and get turned, and that's where that comes from. A good positive play from Scotland.
0-0 the score on TalkSport 2. Long throw by Tierney for Scotland, high towards the corner of the penalty area. Dykes trying to nod it infield. Little drop for Christie has brought that down beautifully out of the air, then nudges it backwards with the outside of his left foot to find Hickey. Hickey back to the halfway line now, and Porteous and Scotland enjoying a good spread of possession. Can they carve out, though, what would be their first clear-cut opportunity? Norway have had one of those, the header from Sorlot in the first half that he should have done better with. Scotland haven't really seriously threatened the Norway goal yet.
No, they haven't, but they just have to try and keep the ball a little bit longer, not force, just go long for the sake of it, like Angus Gunn there, just giving them back the ball. We have to try and build, move angles, move quicker to get on the ball.
It's a clever flick ball over the top by Ødegaard to find Sorlot. He's brought it down in front of the Scotland fans. Right wing position to the dead ball line. Floats it across. Now, that looked like a foul. Penalty given. Foul on Erling Haaland at the back post. He was sent sprawling to the ground by Porteous, who gets a yellow card. And right on the hour mark, Scotland's hard defensive work is undone, and Norway really out of nothing have a penalty kick.
Yeah, it's a foul, it's a penalty. What I said about Porteous again, lack of discipline, getting too tight, allowing him across the front of you and pulling him back. It's a penalty kick. Good movement enough from Haaland to get across the front, but disappointment from Scotland there. You can't get too tight to Haaland. He gets there and allows it to go and give the referee opportunity to call for a penalty.
Scotland's best laid plans might go awry here, having kept Haaland so quiet. It's the number 9, the treble winner, who's going to place the ball on the spot here. 52 goals in the regular season for Manchester City, and now with a chance to become Norway's 7th highest goal scorer of all time. He's got 21 in 23 caps before today. Can he make it 22 in 24 and really potentially blast Norway back into contention in Euro 2024 qualifying? It's in front of the Scotland fans against Angus Gunn. Haaland left footed and he squeezed it beyond Gunn and into the corner. The goalkeeper gets the right way. There was just too much power on the penalty. Haaland scores almost inevitably, and it's Norway 1, Scotland 0.
Yeah, it's a good finish. Cools your leg, good power and pace in the bottom corner. Angus Gunn choose the right way, but just didn't get there enough. But goes back to Porteous there, not knowing. Good movement from Haaland, and he bought the foul from him. And it's a penalty kick, but steps up and he tucks it away well.
Well, it's a penalty that, in the end, spoke about the power and just enough placement on it as well to beat Angus Gunn, who knew where it was going, but couldn't keep up with the pace of the ball. Haaland lowered hard into the bottom corner. And Steve Clarke, surely at this point, Charlie, is going to think about changes. And he'll also be so frustrated because Scotland were pretty comfortable up to that point.
Yeah, for 60 minutes, we've been comfortable enough. We've not allowed Haaland and Ødegaard really to have control of the match. And one bit of ill-discipline has cost them there. And Norway go 1-0 up. But yeah, I look like you're shankling this. But you'll be looking to try and get them on because they've scored a lot of goals this season. And hopefully we can try and get back into this match now.
Well, actually Norway who are making a change. Stole back and going off. Straight after the goal, which is quite unusual for a team who've just gone in front. His replacement is the Sheffield United former club record signing. At one time he was the club record signing. Sander Berger, who we know all about in England for his exploits, of course, most recently in the Championship, but he's impressed at Premier League level as well. So the first change is a Norway change, and with just under half an hour to go, Scotland have it all to do, trailing by a goal to nil, and they've got to open up now a bit, Charlie.
Yeah, that's it. Now Scotland have got to go, and the onus is on Scotland now to go in there. We don't want to get done on the counter-attack.
It will be. Now you feel a little more about Scotland going forward. John Carver, the assistant head coach, is bellowing out instructions from the edge of his technical area. No sign of any imminent Scotland changes just yet, but Haaland kept quiet in open play, but fouled inside the penalty area and tucked it away pretty nicely. There's a free kick for a foul by Dykes on Ryerson, and Norway in control of the game at the moment.
Yeah, just, you know, long throw there, just in the line. We need a bit more movement off the off a throw in, try and get on the ball and do things. Liam Cooper coming on now.
And Scotland, all three centre-halves are on yellow cards, and I wonder whether that is maybe some of the consideration for Steve Clark.
He must be thinking something, or maybe one of them has a niggle and are going to change. Because of the yellow card. But no, Scotland now have to try and, you know, pull something out, and they have to try and be more aggressive and go for the game.
But a throw out on the far side of the right wing position. The referee, before Scotland can take it, is going to allow the change to be made, and it's Cooper and Tierney. Ian Cooper's 16th cap.
I think that's an injury. I think he's obviously taken off because he's got an injury, or he's, you know, because there's no other way he would take Tierney off. So there's a blow, but Cooper there can come in, slot in that left centre half position and try and keep the same, but we have to try and go for the game a little bit more.
It's a concern for Scotland ahead of Georgia at Hampden on Tuesday. McGregor's crossfield ball from right to left to find Robertson. Robertson has controlled it well, lives across, it takes a big deflection, loops up into the air, and it's headed away by Ryerson from just inside the penalty area. Scotland have it again now. Forward ball by Porteous through the middle is intercepted, and now Norway can break and clear. Haaland driving over the halfway line. He's laid it square to Erdogan. Haaland calling for it again through the middle. It's flipped high towards him. Back header in the end is a good one by Robertson into the gloves of Gunn, and that Norway attack comes to an end. Norway 1, Scotland 0. 20 minutes into the second half on TalkSport 2.
What a difference a goal makes, isn't it? Haaland, he's just come alive now. He's just throwing Cooper at the way there, embarrassed him there, and you know, this choice of pass there from Origar was wrong, but Alan looks like he's come a bit of life now, and he's enjoying himself.
Ryerson's still on the halfway line. Back it goes to Strandberg. Amazing, isn't it, that, you know, you can get a little confidence boost like that even as a player who is arguably the best in the world at the moment.
We've said there, Joe, for 60 minutes he's not had a kick, you know, and all of a sudden his moment is that he comes off and, you know, gets a penalty, scores the goal and gives Norway a lead, and then all of a sudden you feel a little bit better about yourself. So the more he does that, like you say, the longer the game goes on and he keeps getting supply, then he's a huge danger to Scotland.
Andy Robertson, raking ball crossfield, left to right to find his opposite wing back Aaron Hickey. Not seen much of Hickey in an attacking position today. Haven't seen a great deal of Scotland as an attacking force in the game, but they've got possession now with McTominay. 10 yards from the corner of the penalty area. Back to McGregor. Forward to Dykes. Dykes digs the ball up into the air. It's headed away this time by Ostergaard. The loose ball has dropped to Hickey. Fouled on the edge of the box. Referee plays the initial advantage. He's surely got to bring it back now for a free kick to Scotland, who have nodded it forward with McGregor. Headed away by Ostergaard. Bit of head tennis on the edge of the Norway box. Scotland have it with McGinn. He steered it wide to the left side, and Robertson. Robertson back in field to McGregor. I'm not sure why the referee didn't give a free kick.
Still more free kick. Brilliant anticipation there from Hickey, and he gets a foul and the referee never gave it. But you know, Scotland probably would have wanted the free kick there, try and get a shot on target.
Still very warm in Oslo. Cooper playing the ball from the sunshine to the shade now. McTominay Porteous. Back to Hendry, and the Norway fans are bouncing up and down with delight. They haven't had much to cheer, certainly not in the qualifying campaign so far, but they could be heading for a victory that would take them second in the group and would leave them just 2 points behind Scotland. And suddenly, Scotland's position in the group, which has looked so secure early on, is a little bit more in the balance.
Yeah, it's what Steve said, that one bad result, one defeat, and you know, it could turn the whole thing around. And if Scotland lose tonight, then it could turn the whole group around. So it's something that Scotland have to do. We have to try and get our way back into this game and let's say maybe make a couple of substitutions in the next couple 10 minutes.
If Scotland equaliser, of course, changes everything again. Here is Hickey on halfway, the number two. When you look at the Scotland bench, Charlie, who are you looking at if you're Steve Clarke to come and make an impact?
I'm looking straight at Nisbet. I'm looking straight at Shanklin, who can go and give you a goal threat. You know, they've scored a few goals this season between the two of them.
So Carvan Cooper on Ødegaard in the centre circle, and Norway content with the lead, just slowing the game down at every opportunity now. Steve Clarke takes a swig from a water bottle. Scotland have been on a good unbeaten run in competitive matches. They haven't lost a competitive game since the Nations League defeat to the Republic of Ireland back in June of 2022. But after a year without losing, competitively, as I say, well, maybe about to come to an end. Unless they can find an equaliser. 21 minutes that remain. They're 1-0 down to Norway.
I think that, let's say, they had 10 clean sheets in the last, you know, was it 18 games or something like that as well. So
that's a shot from Solot, deflected just wide. Curling effort from the edge of the penalty area. Left foot, it was heading for the far corner. Took a crucial touch off Cooper, otherwise it might have beaten Angus Gunn.
Yeah, good play. Positive from Ødegaard. 1v1, Robertson allowing him inside and hits Cooper in the shoulder, but that was travelling fast as well, looking maybe possibly going in that top corner.
You have to say ultimately it's a good block from Liam Cooper.
Yeah, great block, you know, but Robertson there could have got tighter, allowing him inside, showing him onto his strong side, should have, you know, shown him down the line and trying to block the cross.
Scotland with the real pressure here. 20 minutes to go, 1-0 down. Arsenis with the corner, heading wide. Birch should have scored. The Sheffield United man on the edge of the six-yard box has missed a glorious chance.
Yeah, it's gone there. I think there's a foul on Porteous there, but Xander Birch again, free of the ball. He's got to do better. Oh, he's got to at least hit the target, and he goes wide, and his hands are in his head, and that was a big chance there for Norway.
Big opportunity for the Sheffield United player, the newly re-arrived Premier League player, but he couldn't get his header on target with Gunn. Statuesque and probably beaten. Header by Dykes downfield for Scotland. He's not been able to get into the game at all, and that header has drifted harmlessly out of play for a goal kick to Norway.
Yeah, it's just frustrating because the game's too stretched now. You know, Angus Gunn's kicking it long and there's nobody up there with Dykes, and if he's winning any flick-ons, nobody can get on to the end of it. So we've got to try, and if we're going to kick, everybody get up and we'll squeeze and we go from there. But we can't allow the game to get stretched. The last 20 minutes here is a crucial period. Don't lose another goal and take yourself away from the game away from you. If we can stay in it a little bit longer, you know, Steve can freshen it up, and hopefully we can get, you know, back into this match.
Forward by Sander Berger up down the right-hand channel. It's going to be chased up and collected by Sorlot, and down went Andy Robertson, who's holding his left shin. It looks like that's a slight worry for Scotland. Robertson has limped back to his feet. We'll just keep an eye on that, with Tierney having gone off. Charlie was saying we think potentially due to what might have been some sort of injury, or maybe more as a precaution, who knows. And Steve Clarke, I'm sure, will let us all know after the game and the build up to Tuesday night, which suddenly looks an even more important game for Scotland now, that home game against Georgia, if it stays like this in particular.
Yeah, absolutely. No, tough game. Georgia, you know, it's been tough for Scotland over the years as well, so, you know, it's not a given. You know, if we can get something out of this, we'd definitely help, because I don't think we've really played to our potential today. I don't think we've played to the levels that we have in the previous two games, but still enough time here for Scotland to get something.
opportunity for Norway now with Arsnes. He's driving in field from the left-hand side onto his right foot. A reverse ball that was aimed at Haaland. The right idea, but not the right execution. It was way over hit, and through it went to Angus Gunn. I suppose if you're Steve Clarke in Scotland at this point, Charlie Adam, you're thinking, can we carve out one clear chance in the remaining 17 minutes? Maybe most importantly right now, Andy Robertson is down and maybe looking like he might have to come off.
Yeah, looks like he's got an injury there going down, and is it his calf possibly? So yeah, now Steve, listen, we've got to just try and stay in as long as we can at this, and hopefully that, you know, we can get somebody on or an opportunity set player, half a chance where we can maybe get a draw. But said before, if we can get a draw at this game and, you know, and win on Tuesday night, I think it's been a decent enough, you know, couple of games. But at the moment, we need to find something, a bit of magic from somewhere. Is it a Christie? Is it, you know, is it a McTominay run or something? We need to find somebody to go and get us back into this match, because we've underperformed so far today. I don't think we've really played to that level that we have in the previous matches.
Well, the Robertson challenge was with Sorloth. It looked relatively innocuous initially, but often, I guess, that we often say that, don't we, I think, in terms of challenges.
Yeah, they're normally the worst ones. You don't think there's much in it, and you end up coming off worse. So hopefully it's not too serious or too bad that he has to come off.
It's Hartanami watching on the way to our right. Almost all of them on their feet. That's the end of the field where Haaland scored a pretty perfect penalty, actually. He just placed it with great power into the bottom corner, and Gunn guessed from his run-up that Haaland was going to go that way, but he couldn't keep it out.
Nah, the power and the pace of that pass into Angus Gunn's right-hand side was too much, and we talk about it, he's not really had much involvement in the match, but when he's been called upon in that big moment, the penalty, he stuck it away, and he could, you know, at the moment could be walking away with the match winner.
Robertson is back on the field, and that's pleasing for Scotland fans. There is Cooper playing it back to Gunn. So Robertson continues for now. We'll keep an eye on if there's any further issues for Andy Robertson. The ball is on the edge of the Scotland penalty area. They've got it with the defender Hendry. Back to Gunn once more. 15 minutes to go. Norway 1, Scotland 0. Plus stoppage time. Live on TalkSport 2. We'll bring you whatever's remaining here. Norway have won it back with Burgess, scooping it under the feet of Christie and playing it back to Melling. Have to say, from my perspective anyway, Charlie, you know, of course you may well think differently, but I'm surprised that there hasn't been an attacking change for Scotland yet.
As an Englishman, you mean? No, I'm the same. I think last 15 minutes, you know, you got Shanklin on, scored over 20 goals this year. Looks like, well, yeah, we've got to make a sub now. But I thought we would have probably brought somebody on a little bit earlier and really had a go.
Here is Haaland. He's brought it down beautifully, corner of the penalty area, onto that left foot, looking really menacing now. Plays reverse ball to Arsnes, right hand edge of the penalty area, drove it back across, but not with any great power or direction. Cleared away easily by Jack Hendry on the edge of the 6-yard box. Now McTominay, midway inside his own half, up towards John McGinn. Backwards it goes to McGregor. Can Scotland build again here? Can they move the ball a little bit quicker? They haven't been able to do that in the attacking third at the moment, and it's all a bit pedestrian at times.
Yeah, they've not moved it, like you said, not moved it quick enough. Not got it once to get it out in through Callum McGregor, out the other side, and trying to release one of the outside centre-backs maybe to join in as well. We have to try and do something a little bit different now in terms of what we're doing. We have to go and commit a little bit more bodies forward and try and get back into this match.
Here's an opportunity for maybe McTominay to deliver across from the right wing position. It's played back instead towards McGregor, and he sees his attempt at a cross charge down. Scotland have it now with Hendry, about 15 yards shy of halfway. McGregor back to Cooper in the sun. They only need one chance here, Scotland, and they'd certainly take a draw at this point. Probably would have taken a draw before the game, to be fair, too. Crossfield ball by McTominay out to the left, and it's controlled by Andy Robertson, who tries to flick it over the head of Ryerson. And Robertson has looked dangerous on a couple of occasions in the second half, but Ryerson deals with him this time. And here come Norway with Sorloth. He's bursting forward up towards halfway. Checks back infield. He's wriggled away from Christie. Sorloth content to just keep possession. Norway know they don't need to force the issue. They're about 13 minutes away from getting themselves really right back into contention to qualify.
Yeah, I think over the piece at the moment, I think Norway, they've had most of the ball and they've shown real intent second half than they have first half. But you know, it's I look at Scotland's thing and I think that we have to do more. I think we have to be braver on the ball. We have to look like we're wanting to go forward quicker as well.
There'll be two changes now for Scotland, Billy Gilmore and Kenny McLean. Off goes Callum McGregor, first of all. Stuart Armstrong's going to come on as well, so it'll be a triple change for Scotland. Billy Gilmore onto the field. Billy Gilmore of Brighton and Hove Albion. And Christie's also coming off. Steve Clark really ringing the changes now at this point, and as well he might at this stage. The other change, seeing Porteous replaced by McLean. What do you make of all that, Charlie?
Yeah, still look, we've got two strikers on the bench, get them on. You know, it's, we've brought in two midfielders there, three midfielders really, and it looks like a bit of a change in shape for Scotland now. So yeah, listen, Steve's seeing what he sees and then he'd want to go with this, but hopefully we can create something that we can get back into it.
Norway want to make a change as well. That's another player that regular listeners to TalkSport will have heard about before, Mo Elyounoussi, whose spell at Southampton is about to come to an end. Celtic fans will know him as well. 2 years on loan at Parkhead for Elyounoussi during his time at Southampton, and it's Sorlot, the former Crystal Palace man, who's replaced. So Scotland have made three changes. Steve Clark still got the opportunity of more before the final whistle. Now Shankland and Nisbet haven't had too much football in a Scotland shirt, either of them. Backheaded by Cooper to the gloves of Gunn, but you'd think we'll probably see one of them in the final 10 minutes at some stage.
Yeah, I think you'll probably see more of Shankland than you will Nisbet, but yeah, Steve's looking, bringing on three sort of little bit more of experienced players than Shanklin and Nisbet. So looks like McGinn's going and playing off Dykes now with a little bit of a change in shape. So hopefully it brings something to Scotland. Hopefully we can create, you know, an opportunity that we can get off our seats and get back into this game.
A great noise from the Scotland fans, even despite the scoreline. They're 1-0 down here, given away by Odegaard. 10 minutes to go. Is there just one chance in Scotland here? That may be all they need. Playing away from the end that houses their supporters, kicking from right to left towards the home end in this second half. And the bagpipes are being played in that away section. And the ball is with the feet of Liam Cooper now. And Scotland, they have changed shape. Onto a back four. But Tomine finding Gilmore midway inside his own half. Gilmore with the orange boots on. Diminutive midfield player. Now out to McLean on the left. Back it goes to Robertson. Robertson swings the ball crossfield, left to right. Brought down by Hickey, who took it in his stride. Hickey plays it forward up the far side channel to Armstrong. Back now to Gilmore. Can Scotland build? It's Norway suddenly who've got plenty of their red shirts behind the ball. And it's Scotland who've got to find the incisiveness to create something.
Yeah, there you go, that pass again from Cooper. I think Scotland just have to try and use Angus Gunn a little bit more. You know, they had the opportunity to go out the goalkeeper and go out the other side, but instead we kept it in that position.
Hickey's had to get in front of Haaland, who surely was coming across from an offside position. He's tripped Hickey. And it'll be a free kick to Scotland in the right back spot. Defender was just about the favourite there. After Elyounoussi's crossfield ball, maybe he wasn't offside, Haaland.
No, I don't think he's offside, but you know, Hickey does well just to get in front of Haaland. It's a foul, but you know, don't really want to be running into Haaland, do you?
It was a formidable challenge.
he's a strong character.
A robust challenge, to say the least. That's a handball, it looked like, on halfway, and a free kick to Scotland just inside Norway territory, won by Billy Gilmore, who has not scored for Scotland, actually hasn't scored in his entire career for club or country. This would be a fine day to change all that, but Scotland are coming forward now with McTominay down by the corner flag. Going to play it backwards to Hickey. Hickey's got Gilmore in field. Gilmore dinks it up the right-hand channel. Poor ball. It's come back to Gilmore, who went for goal. Thundered off the back of Patrick Berg, out of play for a Scotland throw.
Yeah, Gilmore's got to just get on the ball. He's got to, things have got to come through him, because he's a very good footballer. He can see a pass, and now it's important that he goes and gets on it and gives us a bit of intensity to our play. And you know, that last 10 minutes of the match, we could put it into an area.
Robertson delivers towards Dykes, but there's a foul by McTominay. And for once in the game, Dykes had got himself into a promising position, had that header to knock it back across at the far post, but McTominay had already committed a foul. And it's been a really frustrating watch, I think, for Scotland fans at times.
Yeah, absolutely. I think it has been frustrating. It's been like an end-of-season match for Scotland tonight. They've just not performed, let's say, before, not performed to the levels we have in the previous two games in this group. But, you know, it's, there's no doubt that's Norway side. They're a good team. Some good players, and at the moment I think they've done a bit of a job on Scotland, frustrated them, not really had much of the ball and caused them any problems. So yeah, we'll have to go, and Haaland coming off as well.
Gets a standing ovation, does Haaland. It's part of a triple change. Berg has also left the field. Jürgen Strand Larsen coming on for Norway. Haaland's got his goal from the penalty spot beyond Angus Gunn. Would you believe it? His 59th goal for club and country this season, Harland. 59.
Not bad, eh?
It's not bad. Beyond belief.
Yeah, listen, I think he's come to England. We knew he would score goals, but we never knew it was the way and the rate that he scored them. And fair play to him. You know, he's been robust. He's played a lot of games. He's been part of a lot of wins for Man City, and obviously been a big focal point for them during the season. But to score 59 goals in a season has been phenomenal, and he's got a lot to try and go for next year as well.
Arsnes has also gone off, and the other two players coming on for Norway as Ødegaard spins and turns edge of the box, right-footed shot, great block. Sliding in was Hendry. That was an important challenge. Mats Moladali, formerly of Cardiff, and Christian Torsvet, son of the former Tottenham goalkeeper Erik Torsvet, and the other two have come on for Norway. Ødegaard screaming at the referee, doesn't feel that he should have been penalised. John McGinn went down. Free kick Scotland halfway, 5.5 to go. Scotland looking here for a busy finish to the game on TalkSport 2, 1-0 down.
Listen, great reaction from Ødegaard. He runs 40-50 yards to try and win the ball back, and I think it's not a foul. I think he wins the ball, but the follow through, you know, goes on McGinn and takes him down.
Armstrong for Scotland, right wing position. Back it goes to Hickey. Norway's lead is a very slender one. No Haaland on the field now for the final minutes. Robertson plays it square into the path of Hendry. Hickey again takes over. Infield now to McGinn in the central position. Back to Liam Cooper in the centre circle. Andy Robertson angles the ball out wide left to McLean. And faced up by a sea of red shirts in front of him. There are plenty back behind the ball now for Norway, who know they just have to be well drilled and well organised in the last 4 minutes plus stoppage time. And then they'll see it out and they'll get themselves right back in contention in the group. Scotland have it with the goalkeeper Gunn, a long way from where they need the ball to be. Hickey's in the right back position. It goes to Hendry. Just looking a little lacking in ideas, Scotland.
Yeah, we just laboured and you know, no real intensity to what we're trying to do and build, and you know, get the Gilmores and McTominay on the ball. We need to start passing it forward a lot quicker.
John McGinn playing it through the middle towards McLean. It's well intercepted. Loose ball drops to Dykes.
Yeah,
he's put it in. Scotland have rescued themselves, and Lyndon Dykes has scored a massive goal in the race to reach Euro 2024. They haven't been at their best, but they've got themselves the goal they wanted. Lyndon Dykes has hardly been in the game. It was a poacher's finish. His first Scotland goal since September 2022. The Tartan Army delighting in that. Norway 1, Scotland 1. Scotland right back in control.
Ah, beautiful. What a goal. Lyndon Dykes. That's why Steve Clark didn't want to take him off and bring on Nesbitt and then Shanklin. But well, brilliant reacts, brilliant to the mistake from a defender. He scores in there, and it was a poacher's goal, just nicks it by the goalkeeper and 1-1. What a goal in the last 4 or 5 minutes of the match.
There's that chance we're talking about, Charlie.
Yeah, you need it. Just one opportunity. Scotland have been disappointing tonight. No real intensity to our play. We've looked laboured, but the guys keep going. They stick at it. They've given opportunity. Steve brought the subs on, and Big Dixie there has just got to manage to get the goal, and hopefully, you know, we can get out of here with a point and look forward to Tuesday now.
That's a huge moment for Scotland in their qualifying campaign on a day where they've been far from their best, just their third effort on goal in the game so far, and Lyndon Dykes, it rolled beyond the goalkeeper. And Norway don't have Haaland on the field. They have glum faces now, and Scotland are looking for another. John McGinn at the back post, left-footed. Dykes is there. McLean! Yes! Kenny McLean! Scotland have scored 2 in a minute, and they've turned it around to lead. Once you credit it, Kenny McLean off the bench to surely win the game in Norway. And this is Scotland, loud and proud in Oslo. A new type of Scottish national team. They never give up these days. They've come back to surely win it. And they're going to extend their lead at the top of the group. And maybe when we look back on it, this will be the crucial couple of minutes in this most crucial of matches, and are Scotland fated to be heading to Germany next year? It's Norway 1, Scotland 2. What a moment for Kenny McLean.
Ah, brilliant. What a group of players. Never give up. What opportunity. 87th, 88th minute. Two goals. Turn the whole game on its head. And what an opportunity for Scotland to go. You know, 8 points clear here of Norway. What a chance, and Kenny there struck it in with his right foot. Huge goal for Scotland.
Unbelievable moments, and what celebrations on the touchline, led by Steve Clark.
Absolutely, it's what they work for, and they know that they've not played well, but they've managed to go to Norway tonight and hopefully get a win that can get them and secure that top position at the moment. Away from Spain and Norway, this is a big result for Scotland if they can hang on.
Well, that goal could change everything.
Well, it has, because 5 minutes ago we were saying how laboured Scotland were, how poor, disappointed that they've been, and they've turned it around, and that's what this group of players have done. They've got a mentality in the group that they never give up, and you're just watching Odegaard here, he's the gobsmacked, and that's what happens with teams when you get the right camaraderie and you get the right spirit. You know, gives you an opportunity, and the lads have turned this game on its head.
6 added minutes, another change for Scotland. What a moment for Dom Higham to make his Scotland debut, the Blackburn defender, on in place of John McGinn. And Scotland are nearly there. Fantastic awareness by Dykes, by the way, for the goal, Charlie.
Oh, brilliant, because he goes and wins it, hangs up in the air, and he goes and wins it, and then he rolls it into Kenny McLean just to safe foot it, and normally you could have blasted it or lashed at it, and Kenny McLean tucks it away with his right foot. You know, that's what you want, is a sub impact, make an impact, come and show us something, and he reacted in the right way, and this could be a crucial goal for Scotland go forward.
Well, Norway, plenty of home fans are heading for the exits now. I wonder whether some in the Norway camp will question some of the changes. A lot of changes. Haaland taken off before the goal, lacking his presence there.
Yeah, I think, like you say, you're 84 minutes, and you know, a lot of things going through what Haaland's been through in the last couple of weeks, maybe taking his toll, and you want to see the subs. You make, you know, defensive opportunities, because you think the game's is gone. And but when you're playing against this Scotland team, they never give up, and you know, two chances, and they've managed to take the two goals, and hopefully, you know, we can see it over the next 5 minutes.
Norway 1, Scotland 2 on TalkSport 2. We're a minute through the 6 added here. Scotland heading for 3 wins from 3 in their qualification group for Euro 2024. It would put Norway in massive difficulty. Huge trouble. They were 1-0 up through Erling Haaland's penalty, but two goals in 90 seconds for Scotland. Dykes and Kenny McLean off the bench, and Scotland are nearly there. They're just a few minutes away from what would be a massive victory, but there's still some work to do for them. They've got a free kick to defend. Ødegaard is standing over it. What? Midway inside the Scotland half. It's just left of centre. Too far out for a shot, but he's going to try and whip it in here, Martin Ødegaard. And can Scotland, can that defensive rear guard hold firm? You have to say, Norway haven't created a great deal in open play. Can they do something from a set piece? It's a poor set piece by Ødegaard. He fooled everybody, including, it seemed, his own teammate Melling, who wasn't expecting the pass to the left at all. It's gone out of play. It's a goal kick to Scotland, and the cheers from the Scotland fans tell you all you need to know.
Yeah, poor decision from Ødegaard there, the opportunity just to put it in the box, but as a Scotland supporter, we'll take that, and we can get up the pitch and, you know, organise that. And yeah, I'm still a bit gobsmacked from that turnaround of the two goals in 2 minutes. But brilliant result if we can see it through to the end now.
Charlie Adam, former Scotland midfielder, with us for commentary on TalkSport 2. They're nearly there. Halfway through the six added minutes, Norway have gone long, deep into the Scotland half. Scotland win it back. Will be cleared away shortly here by McLean. He's been tripped. It's an obvious foul. It's a free kick. Well, you have to hand it to Scotland. I think maybe teams going back over the years wouldn't have got themselves back into this game, but there's a new resolve about this Scotland
side.
Yeah,
I totally agree with Joe. I think there's a determination, there's a mindset and a mentality of winners in this group. You know, where they're at, the clubs that they're at, they've driven that, and Steve and his staff have got that camaraderie amongst the group, and they all want to be there, they all want to fight for each other, and it's shown with the performance and the results that they've had so far to come back. Let's say 86, 87 minutes, they're turning a game like this round. They've scored late in many games under Steve's reign, and hopefully that can continue. And you know, results like tonight, going away to Norway and hopefully getting a win can give them more confidence for the rest of this group.
Scotland fans looking up into the sunshine. The game's not done yet. Norway playing from left to right towards that Scotland away end. It's a header away from the heart of the back line by Scotland's Dom Higham on his debut for the national team. Norway will come again with El Yunusi. 4 minutes and 15 seconds of the six added have been played. It's not over yet. Ødegaard into the D, spinning and turning, playing it wide to the near side, and Ryerson, a low ball in, cut out at the near post by Andy Robertson. The Scotland captain gets it away. 90 seconds to go. Scotland have got everybody back behind the ball. Can they hold firm here, having worked so hard to turn the game around? They've only got seconds left, Norway. They really need a win, Norway. A draw isn't really good enough for them. It's a tackle by McLean. Every touch from a Scotland player is being cheered to the rafters by 1,300 away fans. They're 2-1 up here, Scotland. They've still got work to do. The ball is with Norway, and Berger, midway into the Scotland half, taken up by Ødegaard, trying to poke it through the middle. It'll be blocked off again, once more by Robertson. Scotland will have to look at that potential injury that he suffered in the second half after the game, but he's moving okay now. Ryerson's cross, headed away again. The opportunity now for Gilmore to break. He's nudged it to the right in Armstrong. That was very sensible from Billy Gilmore. Armstrong will slow it down as he moves into opposition territory. Can't get beyond Berger. Sends it back to the keeper. 35 seconds to go, 2-1 Scotland.
Yeah, good organisation. Great header there from Callum Henry, and from Jack Henry there. And get Scotland back up the pitch, but it's important we see this out the last 40 seconds.
Header away by Jack Hendry. They would be 8 points clear of Norway. 8 points clear of Georgia to Scotland as it stands. Georgia who play Cyprus later. And the final whistle is blown. Tartan Army passion and pride in abundance. A massive win for Scotland in the race for Euro 2024. They've come from behind to defeat Norway, who many saw as one of their biggest threats to qualification. They were a goal down, Scotland, but two goals in the final 3 minutes of normal time have turned the match on its head. It's a famous win for Steve Clarke's team. Three wins from three to start their qualifying campaign. They're now in a magnificent position to reach Germany next summer. Haaland with the penalty for Norway, but Dykes and McLean turned it around. Norway 1, Scotland 2. What a result, Charlie Adam.
Yeah, huge result. You know, for 86, 87 minutes, one goal down, and then all of a sudden, moment there for Scotland. We just said, can we create one moment? All of a sudden, we created two moments to win the game, and I think this is a big, big result for this group. You know, going 8 points clear of Norway, who on tonight, it's shown at times, are a good side. You know, good technical players can cause you problems, but no, it's a great result for Scotland, and hopefully now we can go to Tuesday night with a little bit more confidence. And hopefully we can play a little bit better and get the same result.
I think Scotland would have been delighted with the point in the circumstances, Charlie, but to go on and win it as well.
Yeah, I think once you, like you say, got that mindset of, we were saying there, oh, it's okay to come and maybe get a point, but once you get that goal and you get to 1-1, you think, okay, can we go and go again? And we create one moment again, and, you know, big Lyndon there sticking the ball in the net to get eagle-eyed, and then Kenny McLean showing great composure just to get that second goal, but... Yeah, it's a huge result.
Well, you have to applaud Lyndon Dykes in particular, because we had been saying at one stage, and it wasn't necessarily down to him, but he'd hardly had a kick of the ball, and then one instinctive finish, and then the awareness to lay it back to McLean for the second goal. He's more than played his part.
Yeah, it could have been easy to be a little bit selfish and try and get the turn and shoot and maybe that, but he's seen that Kenny McLean was in a good position. He rolls it back, and Kenny just, you know, passed it into the net, and... It's a good result. Scotland fans are very, very happy, and these group of players now can look forward to Tuesday.
8 points clear of third, at least for now. They will play Georgia on Tuesday night. How important is it, Charlie, that Scotland follow that up with another victory at Hampden?
Yeah, definitely. It's a game that we're expected to win, and you know, if they can do that, then it will give us a little bit more of an opportunity to qualify for Germany. And if we can keep doing that, the spirit, the togetherness, the camaraderie is in that group, and you know, they never seem to lie down, and 3 points, and we move to Tuesday now against, you know, a Georgia team that will come and frustrate, and we've got to be ready for that.
Charlie, great stuff, really enjoyed it today. Charlie Adam, former Scotland midfielder, with us on TalkSport 2 for commentary. Lots more live football coming up on the network on Monday nights. England against North Macedonia from Old Trafford on TalkSport. Turkey, Wales at the same time on TalkSport 2. Australia at the Ashes, 311 for 5 at Stumps. Another absorbing day's cricket at Edgbaston. For all the reaction to day 2 of the first Ashes test, you can join John Norman and double Ashes winner Steve Harmison for following on Ashes Inquest on TalkSport at 7 o'clock tonight. They'll be taking your calls and discussing all the major talking points after every day's play. Here in Oslo, Scotland 2-1 winners at Norway, 3 wins from 3 to start the qualification campaign for Steve Clark's team. Next up on TalkSport 2, our man Danny Kelly sits down with a legend of Scottish football, none other than Manchester United's Dennis Law, in My Sporting Life.